Welcome to the Serious TV Drama Podcast with Scot and Dan. I'm Scot, and with me as always, the Picard to my Kirk, the Jackass to my Jerk, it's Dan. How are you doing tonight, Dan?
I'm doing splendid, fantastic.
Splendid and fantastic. That's nice.
And how are you?
I'm feeling not so bad.
better than the usual leading up to the holidays.
I have to be honest. I've barely given the holidays much thought this year, which is not necessarily a bad thing.
I don't care about them either. I just recall you having a few rough ones the last several years.
Yeah, we can just leave it at that. December hasn't necessarily been a kind month to me in the past. Over the past few years. And this one started off pretty badly because I've been sick off and on, it seems like, for the last few months. But I feel mostly healthy tonight, which is a good thing because we're going to be doing a lot of talking on this podcast.
So maybe December isn't kind to you because there isn't a lot of quality first-run TV shows on. Fortunately, the rest of the year had plenty of that.
Well, there is that, although the folks at Netflix are making it hard on us because they're just starting to jam all these great shows in at the end of the year now for some reason. But speaking of great shows and whatever, we should probably start right off by saying this is our Best of 2017 podcast. It's an annual tradition. Yay. Usually is where we cue in like the audience clapping or whatever silly sound effects we used to do back
or Mason Verger.
Yes, we will not. due to an illness in the Verger family, or i.e. I'm not really sure if my throat could handle it after the last few months of being sick, we will not be joined by Mason Verger this evening like we were last year, unfortunately.
Yeah, I was looking at her file for this from last year, and it has a list of all the different pieces of music I put in. And I'm just like, why the hell did I put Hannibal music in? That wasn't on last year. So then I look, and it's like, oh, I had the Hannibal theme playing in the background while you were talking, talking about pig fucking and stuff.
Well, hey, you know what? It's probably going to be a long night. You never know. Maybe Mason might make a surprise appearance later in the podcast. Anything is possible in these unscripted shows that we're doing. But it's been an annual tradition that we, at the end of the year, we like to look back and kind of go over what we thought were the best shows of the year, as well as some other little side categories that we enjoy sprinkling into the podcast as well. I know that even in a year like this where there were literally a few months where I barely watched any TV, which sounds strange for me to say that out loud because I'm such a TV junkie, but I always tend to watch considerably more stuff than you do because you actually do things with your life and you go outside and hike and climb and whatever. But that said, I always want to remind folks when they listen to a list like this, especially mine, which will be a bit longer than yours. I can't watch everything. and we're both fans to whatever degree of TV critic like Alan Sepinwall. And I remember reading his stuff like a year or two ago, and he talks about these shows that he's heard are good, and he's sure there are, but he just doesn't have time. And that's his chosen profession, is to watch TV and talk about it and write about it. But he can't watch everything. Like, for example, Peaky Blinders, which just started today and just got released today, and therefore I can't make my list. Although I'm sure if we were doing this next week, I bet it would make my list. I've just watched the first half hour. I'm already in love with the show. He mentioned that he has not ever been able to watch Peaky Blinders. He's like, I've heard it's good. I'm sure it is. You can only watch so many shows. And he mentioned a few other things. So,
yeah, I think you and me both, more you than me, but, we try to watch some of the shows Netflix puts out, but who the hell has time to watch all the HBO and Netflix and Hulu and Amazon? Who the hell is paying for all this stuff and, actually making the time to do it? I mean, whatever they're, I suppose it works for some people, but I just can't imagine ever having enough time where I could justify paying for more than one or two of the more premium services,
right.
Regardless of the quality of the shows that I hear about on the various other things I'm not going to be paying for. But it's just like, whoa, man, it's just not possible. Just pick whatever service has the stuff that seems to be the best for you, focus on that, and you're still not, if it's Netflix, you're still never going to catch up.
Yeah, it's just not possible. I mean, it's kind of interesting I haven't looked at any this year, but in years past, you look at, say, a magazine like Entertainment Weekly or something, and they'll have, like, their top 10 TV shows, whatever. And usually, I think sometimes, I know they do it in movies, I don't know if they do it with TV shows the same way, they might. Sometimes we'll have two different critics, and they both give their top 10 lists, and you see what differences there are. But I also think they do that because any one critic can't possibly see everything, can't possibly watch. They always make that reference to something called peak TV. Because, yeah. Like you're saying, there's so many services. There's so many. I mean, there's the money thing for regular people, but that doesn't apply to the TV critics because they're not paying. They're not paying those bills. But it's just the time. There's not enough time to watch all that.
We need to call it pandemic TV now because it's just spread out of control, and there's just no way to stop it. It appears.
Right. So, before I get into what any of my choices, I'll just preface it by saying I don't have Hulu, so therefore a show which I'm sure The Handmaid's Tale is a fantastic show. I've heard nothing but good things about it, and I do hope that someday I'm able to see it, but I'm not able to. Therefore, a show like that can't be on my list. And there's any number of other shows that, it is like a really great, high-quality show, and it's not on the list. It's more likely that I don't have a way to see it, or something like that. I know the second season of The Crown debuted a couple weeks ago. I've yet to watch the first season of The Crown, so I can't watch the second season. Therefore, a show like that couldn't make the list or something like that. And everything else you said, there's a million different cable channels and all these other shows. I did go back and figure out how many shows I watched this year. It's a lot. it's not like I only watched 10 or 12 shows this year. I think on last count, and this wasn't even including comedy series or true comedy series, I should say. I think it was 60 something shows.
Oof.
So that's a lot. And this is a year where I'm already saying I didn't watch as much TV as I normally do. So I don't even want to think of what I did in previous years where I probably watched something more like 70 or 80 shows. So this is what happens when you stay up all night watching TV instead of sleeping like normal people. All right. So like I said, we're going to go through our best of lists here, as well as some other stuff. So should we get this started with, because I watch so much, I can't just do a top 10, which is what you will be doing because you're more normal than I am in that regard. So I'm actually going to blow through the first chunk of my list just to get it out of the way, just so people know where these shows landed. And then we'll talk about our other categories. Does that sound good?
Yep.
Okay. So to start things off, like I said, I actually composed a list of my top 25 shows for the year. So right now, just to get it out of the way, I'm going to zip through 25 through 11, just so people know where certain shows landed. I did look at what I did last year, which I did 20 last year. Taking out the shows that were one-off shows, shows that only existed for one season, The People vs. O.J. Simpson or something like that. It was interesting to see how many shows, where they landed on one list and how different their spot is on this year's list. So there's been there will be a considerable amount of movement, I think. Probably for both of us, I think. But we'll see.
Yeah, definitely.
I am. And also, neither of us know what either of us picked. So anyone listening and any surprises they have, we will hopefully be surprising each other. Although, I'm already wrote down what I think your top couple are going to be. It'll be interesting to see if I'm right or not. But we'll see at the end of the podcast. Okay, so let's start things off with the first chunk of my list, starting with number 25. And my number 25 choice for 2017 was the show American Gods. The only reason it's really making my list, it's a beautiful show to look at, and there's some really terrific performances. The reason why it landed so low on the list, even with Brian Fuller's involvement, and you know Brian Fuller from both Hannibal and what wasn't he involved in one of the Star Trek shows originally, or was it just Discovery?
Brief, no, he was on like Voyager and stuff back in the day.
Okay, but he anyway, widely respected guy in television, creator,
Yeah.
producer, whatever. Problem with the only, but the problem with American Gods, it felt like an entire season of setup and not even really setting up a story. So kind of like the next show I'm gonna on my list's first season was, where it was just set up but not much else. But still kind of enjoyable. I'm kind of hoping they have a second season and it actually goes somewhere. 24, speaking of shows that had their first season was pretty much nothing but setup. Preacher. Their second season was considerably more fun for a nice chunk of it. It kind of got bogged down and monotonous in the middle there, but it really finished
Yeah.
kind of nicely.
I never got past the middle myself. I mean, I still have it on the DVR, but at some point I just kind of got hung up and then focused on other things. But I definitely enjoy what they were doing once they left Odin or whatever the name of the town was.
When you get to when there's one specific character they introduce, and the bigger this part this character plays, the more compelling and more fun the show becomes. And plus, there's an alum from Better Call Saul
Right.
who ends up in it, with not one but two very strange hairstyles.
Yeah.
But yeah, Preacher 24. 23 was the show Taboo that was on FX with Tom Hardy. Maybe slightly more style over substance, but a lot of great performances from a lot of actors people will recognize from everything from Game of Thrones and pretty much any other BBC production. And you get to hear, oh, what's the actor's name? From Brazil, and he was recently on Game of Thrones. Jonathan Pryce?
Yes.
Is that his name?
Yeah, good job.
Pull that out of my ass right there. Kind of fun thing about that, it was the first time I've heard him curse so extensively as he does on Taboo. So, and speaking of Game of Thrones, that was my 23 choice. Game of Thrones this season, it seems
Think it was
like,
22.
what? Oh,
It was
22, excuse me,
22.
thank you.
That's fine.
This is what happens when you scribble things in a notebook instead of typing them on my computer screen. Game of Thrones for me at this point feels like I'm just more waiting for really great scenes and moments, but I'm not necessarily waiting for a great storyline or execution. I know you're a bit more ne I think you're more negative about it than I am,
Oh,
but
yeah.
it but you know that's not to say there's always going to be stuff which is really fun and compelling, and there's definitely really solid actors on the show. The show will never
Yeah.
hurt for want of act. All the actors are always solid. It's just this season became a lot of I know it's a fantasy show, so I hate using the phrase suspend disbelief, but at certain points when people are just doing things that are just stupid and they should clearly know better, you know, it was inexplicable some of the time what they were doing. But we did get to see the dragons, kill the Lannister army. That's kind of fun. So, had that. My 21 choice would be This Is Us. Probably one of the best network dramas that's on right now. The reason why it's ranking so low, because I think a lot of people would think it would be higher up on the list. This second season, although it's had its share of tear-jerking moments, which is what the show is known for. I haven't been as thrilled with what the storylines have been for the characters compared to season one. I'm just not. It's not that I'm not feeling it. I'm just like, ugh. I mean, if anyone out there really was in love with the possible adopting a foster kid storyline with one family, that you're alone, I think. I'm sorry. And it's just been kind of, I wish the show was more like it was in season one, to me, I just feel it's gotten a little dumbed down or something. Maybe not dumbed down. That's not the right phrase. I'm just not feeling the storylines as much. And I don't care how the dad died. You know, I know everyone cares about that. It's like, we'll find that when we find that. That's not bothering me. I just want the storylines to be more interesting.
Does it feel like maybe they're like, you know, they weren't expecting to get so well received in the first season. Now they're kind of like trying too hard, maybe something like that.
I don't know. Maybe. I mean, this is a show. I mean, for the most part, quality performances, and the writing is there to a certain degree, as far as like the words that are coming out of characters' mouths are always true to the character and are well written. But the overall stories are like, they're not hard. I mean, it's just some. For example, one of the characters, one of the main characters, has been week after week has been becoming more and more addicted to like painkillers and that kind of a thing. And it's bothered me that it's not clearly apparent to other people on the show, especially his girlfriend / fiance, whatever, who's a nurse. If there's anyone who should be able to figure that out and see that, it should have been her. Some people said, "Oh, don't you think she kind of picks up on it in this one moment?" Like, no, because she sends him, you know, she wouldn't have let him leave if she thought he'd become a drug addict. So that dumb stuff like that kind of annoys me. But it's still a good show. It's in my top 25. I'm just explaining why it's not a top for me. It's not like a top 10 show. Because I think last season, it did make my list, but I think it might have been in the teens. But that might have been just because there were so many good shows ahead of it. But now it's, what was that number? 21. Number 20 would be the third season of Narcos. Just really good show. A show that first two seasons were all about the rise and fall of Pablo Escobar. And you wonder when they went to season three, how are you going to do a show that was all about Pablo Escobar without Pablo Escobar? I would say they pulled it off. I felt it was maybe a tick or two less than the previous two seasons, but it was still, once that show gets rolling and, you know, and you can stay awake long enough to read all the subtitles, cause you really need to read for that show. It's definitely worth watching. So, I still like it enough. It made my top 20 at number 20.
Yeah.
Number 19, Feud, Betty and Joan. This was the show that was focused on the Joan Crawford, Betty Davis, quote unquote feud that had been going on for many years, and the whole making of whatever happened to Baby Jane. Really a fun, you know, behind the scenes Hollywood kind of a show. Great performances, especially by Jessica Lange and Alfred Molina and Stanley Tucci. So you got a lot of really good quality actors in it. Susan Sarandon too, but her off-screen stuff has been putting me off even looking at her. But you know, she was at least decent in it as well. But that was a lot of fun, and probably one of the best opening credit sequences of any show this year. Totally a Saul Bass homage, you know, and then some. So any classic cinema fans of Saul Bass, go on YouTube and look up the opening credit sequence for Feud, Betty and Joan. It's really nice. It's really gorgeous. My number 18 choice was iZombie. It's that little show that seems to get overlooked on the CW with all the superhero things and everything else that's there. It's a show that just consistently has gotten, I think it's actually gotten better from season to season. Maybe it's because the storylines have become more and more serialized as opposed to self-contained from season to season. And they kind of ended that season with, you kind of wonder what they're going to do in season four, because you had a show where you had the main character and maybe a couple others who were kind of like zombies in secret to, hey, now everybody knows they're zombies and they're pretty much have taken over Seattle. So good luck there next week, Dan. He kind of I'm kind of intrigued at how they're going to approach season four on that show. Number 17, probably one of the shows that I know you haven't been able to watch because it only was released recently, but I anticipate when you do have time, you will check it out, Dan. And that's a show called Godless. It's a new Western that debuted on Netflix about a month ago or a few weeks ago. Limited series, just I think it's just seven, I want to say 7 episodes, if I'm recalling,
Oh,
which is
I'll hit
nice.
that off. Yeah.
Oh, be aware that some of those episodes do go a little bit over an hour, so we're not talking short episodes. But very, very good. It has a really nice, good Western feel to it. It's, you know, if we're comparing TV Westerns, is it in the same league as Deadwood? Nothing's in the same league as Deadwood, you know. But it's that I would definitely put it a couple notches quality-wise over, say, Hell on Wheels. But that's because it's also telling a story within a few episodes, as opposed to sprawling season after season. So they, you know, they have an excuse. But some really good, and also some really exceptional actors on that one. So it's really worth checking out. And a lot of people play against type, which is kind of fun too. This is my personal shocker for me. If you had told me this a couple years ago that I'd be ranking the show so low, I wouldn't have believed you. My number 16 choice is Fargo. Yeah, so Fargo is not unlike the first two seasons, which I think might have both been my number one choices for those seasons, if I'm not mistaken. I think I did, I don't remember. Sounds like I did.
Yeah, so I think so.
By the time it was over, I really liked it. As did you. I think we both enjoyed the second half of the season far more than the first half once it got rolling. But it was never, it just for me, it was never quite as good as those first two seasons. You know, it felt like a show that wanted to be Fargo at times rather than Fargo, if that makes any sense.
Yeah.
Number 15, a show that you all, another show that you, I as I understand it, you've seen. It's this little show on Netflix called Ozark. I finally got a chance to see it a few weeks ago, so it's very fresh in my mind. For the most part, very enjoyable. You got your Jason Bateman, you got your Laura Linney, you know, got some quality people in there. I don't buy into some criticisms of the show if they think it's just, you know, a Breaking Bad wannabe or this or that. Like, no, it's got, you can say there's elements of any number of shows in Ozark. You know, you can see a little bit of Breaking Bad here, you can see a little bit of Justified here, and, you know, probably half a dozen other things. If you haven't seen the show Sneaky Pete, but there's definitely elements of that in there as well. I think the only reason I didn't rank it higher is maybe it didn't, I didn't believe all of it quite as much as I did a show like a Breaking Bad, if that makes any sense. Where
Oh yeah, I
those
can see that.
the, yeah the, there's a bit more implausibility with some of the goings on in Ozark compare that. I mean, obviously, if one took apart Breaking Bad, one could say, "Well, that's ridiculous." Like, well, not really. They ground that show pretty well, no matter how crazy it gets. Ozark, some things about the premise are a little kind of like, but and it's really, and the show seems to be more built around heightening tension and, oh, how the hell are we going to get out of this one from episode to episode? It sometimes it seems like it would have been nice if it, maybe it had, maybe if I cared more about the people involved, if there was that certain human touch to them at certain times. But I did enjoy it a lot, though, and it made me think about, wow, Jason Bateman would have been a good choice for a script I wrote. It's too bad I heard from a casting director he's hell to work with. But anyway, the movie that still has never yet been made. My number 14. Oh, I just mentioned it. 14 choice is actually the show Sneaky Pete, which, but actually putting them side by side, I'm surprised I didn't put that higher because I really enjoyed the show Sneaky Pete. it's on Amazon, so I have to hand it to my best friends. I was able to watch it with them week after week. It's a Bryan Cranston has a huge hand in that show as far as the creation of it, and he also gets to play a villain on it, which is kind of fun to see Bryan Cranston playing someone who's a villain, an out and out villain from the get go, as opposed to someone who quote unquote becomes a villain. He definitely has fun in all his scenes. You haven't, because you don't, do you not have Amazon, Dan?
No, I don't. I mean, I could. I mean, I have friends that are willing to let me use their Prime to watch stuff, but I just haven't.
Well, you don't have the time.
There's 50 shows on Netflix I should probably watch first before I bother to get some friend's username and password and do
Right.
Amazon.
Well, as I go through my list, whatever this, I think I have maybe two or three shows that I know you haven't seen that I put stars next and say, this is a show Dan should watch. And that's the first
Three.
one. There's another one that you really should watch, but that'll come up later in the podcast. But you would definitely enjoy Sneaky Pete a lot, as would everyone else listening out there. Really, really good show. I believe it was just a 10-episode season, so they don't it doesn't outlive its welcome. It's got some great actors on it that you'd recognize from any number of things. Other than the main character Giovanna Ribisi, you've got your Bryan Cranston, you've got Margot Martindale on it. It's really, really, really a good show. My number 13 choice is a show that people don't really talk about that much, but it's really good. It's on TNT. It's called Good Behavior. It's with Michelle Dockery, who also is one of the stars of Godless, but most people know her from Downton Abbey. Talk about playing against type. For those of her who know her from Downton Abbey, on this show, she goes from playing Lady Mary to a con artist, drug addict. I don't know. She's almost a borderline kleptomaniac, even though not quite, whatever. She's really good. And also, I should also say, with our lists, we're talking about the calendar year 2017. So we may very well be talking about shows that had like part of one season earlier in the year and then part of their subsequent season later in the year. And that's how I'm looking at the shows, as opposed to, and because that just is how we're going to do this, I think. So with Good Behavior, they just finished their current season, but they also had their last couple episodes of their first season in this year as well. It's really a good show. I highly recommend it to folks out there. It's just they do an even better job of really like, oh my God, how are they going to get out of this? But you really care. So it's really a good show. Number 12, another show that dropped compared to its first season before, Stranger Things. I like season two of Stranger Things. There are things to really enjoy. It's much more ambitious than the first season in many ways. The reason why it falls down for me on the list, because I'm pretty sure the first season might have been my number one or two choice. I can't remember. It's definitely up in my top two or three. There's still, doing the 80s homage thing, whatever. And I like to think that maybe they were almost making a commentary about sequels, which were a big thing in the 80s as well, and how sequels to big movies always tended to be bigger, more expensive. But when you look really closely at them, they're kind of just repeating a lot of the same ideas and storylines from the first movie. And that's kind of what they did, I think, to a certain extent on season two of Stranger Things. That doesn't mean it's not really enjoyable. The kids are all great. There's a lot of fun stuff there. It's number 12 on my list, so I definitely liked it. But I didn't love it with the same kind of adoration that I did the first season. There is one semi-controversial episode of the season that, or at least polarizing. I agree with the people who don't care for that episode very much. It's not that I hate it, but it's easily the weakest episode of the entire series. And once it's over, you realize that episode kind of felt like a waste of time. Couldn't they have just done that in a few minutes or done that with other stuff as well? I didn't see the point of pretty much killing the momentum the season had with this one episode. It was really weird. But other than that, still a fun show. Still looking forward to the third season and where they're going to go with it. But it just didn't. I wouldn't say it had a sophomore slump, but it definitely was not as good as season one. I don't care what other people say. I don't know what they're talking about. It's just, it was not as good as season one. And am I up to my last one? Oh, number 11. My 11th choice, and then we can stop listening to me yap for a bit. My number 11 choice is another Netflix show, and it's a series of unfortunate events, or Lemony Snicket's series of unfortunate events. The show, I think, that debuted early in the year. I think maybe might have debuted way back in January, if I'm not mistaken. I didn't get around to finishing it, getting back to watching it until a couple weeks ago. A lot of fun. It's kind of like, imagine, the Addams Family meets Pushing Daisies kind of a sensibility. It's very self-aware. It's very it's I know Brian Fuller didn't have anything to do with this, but it feels like Brian Fuller had something to do with this. I know Barry Sonnenfeld plays a big part in it, and he's the guy who was the director of the Addams Family movies and the actual creator of the Lemony Snicket novels is very much involved in this TV show as well, so maybe that's helped. Neil Patrick Harris is just a treasure on the show, as is Patrick Warburton. It's just a really good, fun show and kind of a nice break to take when you watch a lot of like really dark, disturbing stuff like your Ozarks and stuff like that. Even though this show is quote unquote very dark, I mean, if you get to hear the opening theme song, it's all about telling people they should really be watching something else because this is just too dark and horrible for them to watch, whatever. But it's fun. It's like calling the Addams Family too dark to watch. No, it's not. You know what I mean? So that would be my number 11 choice. And this is what happens when you don't script something. You get to hear me ramble for however long that was.
I think it's been pretty coherent.
Oh, cool. Okay, so let's take a break from me talking about what I like and let's get to stuff that we can both talk about here. So what should we be tackling next? I'm thinking something of a shocking, surprising nature. Does that sound right?
Yep.
Okay, so let's segue from, the best of 2017 list to, our what we considered our biggest shocking surprises of the year. So what have you got for us, Dan?
In no particular order, I'll just pick the first one that I wrote down. The way they ended Twin Peaks, I was just completely blown away by what they did. And I mean, it's the kind of thing where, I could probably watch it 10 times and I'd still have, not the same reaction, but just one of those like stunned, like, oh crap, what the hell just happened kind of thing.
Yeah, that didn't even occur to me to write that down, but that totally makes sense. I do have something about Twin Peaks written down, so I'll see your last episode of Twin Peaks or last 10, 15 minutes or whatever chunk you were talking about there, and I'll raise you an episode 8
Oh,
of
yeah.
Twin Peaks. Probably the most different and amazing and stunning and bizarre hour of anything I've seen all year or any year.
Yeah.
And I know I'm putting it in the shocking, surprising category, which, it shouldn't be shocking or surprising that something in Twin Peaks would be whatever. But this goes so far, this episode goes so far beyond what they. The insanity that had already happened in earlier episodes of the season and in the history of the show, and it was clear that Showtime just said, "You know what, David, Mr. Lynch, you can just do whatever you want." Because I'm still trying to imagine there being a meeting and someone and them watching this like in a like in a darkened conference room, like, "Wait, what? What was that?" But
Yeah.
just amazing, just amazing. The it's about the genesis of evil, and just I. It was something that I know. You know how a lot of times you'll watch something, and you feel like, oh, I've got to watch that again. Oh, I've got to watch that again. Whatever it is, we can think of any number of shows or things that we've done. I'm not saying I didn't actually go back and watch it again. I did. But I, part of me, it was almost like I didn't have to, because
Yeah.
the images of and the way that was shot and the way everything about that was so burned into my brain upon first viewing that even right now I can remember it minute almost minute by minute. Probably the first 5, 10 minutes are not quite as burned, you know, the stuff with Evil Cooper, but but from like Nine Inch Nails on.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
No, and it definitely is the kind of thing too, where I mean, for the most part, we're, us and a fair amount of people were really into the show before this point. But I don't think anybody was expecting like them to do something that was just like so like that just transcended like of like just the medium in such a way where just like while we're watching it, it's just one of those where you can just tell that like something is just almost historic is happening, but you're watching like fiction. And it's
Yes.
just, it was really, it blew me away. Excellent choice, sir.
What else you got?
Oh, now it's my turn. I wasn't sure you were done.
Yeah, I'm done with that one.
Okay. Okay. I'm not sure the name of the episode. I mean, I could have looked it up, but it's a Mr. Robot episode title, and I'm just not going to try to read the episode title because it's just.
No one reads the episode titles.
No. But anyway, the episode that was basically like just one long, a oneer, I guess, with, a cut or two, placed strategic shots. But while I was, before that point of the season, I don't remember if it was episode 5 or 6, something like that, but it wasn't exactly a crappy season, but it was the kind of thing where, not quite to the level of the Twin Peaks episode that we just briefly discussed, but where as you're watching it, just like, wow, I mean, they're really, really elevating their game here. And just like as you started to like, I mean, you were along for the ride from start to finish. I was anyway. And they just did all sorts of really, fun, crazy stuff. And I
Yeah.
mean, it worked. They executed it very well.
What I loved about how they did that, I mean, obviously there's a certain amount of trickery that's involved because, you know, it can't just physically it can't all be one shot, you know. And they do some of the tricks they do are a little bit more obvious than others. You know, it's almost like an homage to Hitchcock's Rope when it goes past the back of someone. You know, it's probably where they switched the cameras out. But when they do certain things like those overhead angles and over the walls or down the building,
Oh.
whatever, that's some of that was really, I was like, marvelous. Like, wow, Sam Esmail is really outdoing himself here. You know,
Yeah.
he's really taking it up a notch. And I mean, I agree about the season overall, which I believe we'll probably be talking about later in the podcast. But yeah, that would definitely be one of the most memorable hours of television. You know, again, everything probably pales compared to that Twin Peaks episode, but if we were just doing just a list of just memorable episodes, that's in my top 10 as well. Absolutely.
Awesome.
Now this year, you know, I'm not going to talk about I'm not going to pick things that were like, you know, surprising or jaw-dropping, you know, deaths or anything like that, which happened on a number of shows I watched, which I didn't see coming. Mr. Robot's actually one of them, you know, or it could be Mr. Robot, it could be Fargo, it could be probably three or four other shows that happened this season. I'm gonna pick something a little. I'm gonna go in a somewhat different direction with my next and actually probably my last selection for this category. As I've mentioned in our previous best of whatever, I'm a fan of the show Crazy Ex-Girlfriend, and that's a show that started off with a possibly questionable or even disturbing premise to begin with. You know, a girl who's obsessed with some guy, you know, moves, you know, across country to try to pursue him, and it becomes more and more weird as it goes on. This season, it's progressed in a very nice fashion, but it's gotten so dark. And this is a show that, even though I included in our podcast, the quote unquote serious TV drama podcast, I know and honestly, the show is more considered a musical comedy than anything else. But it's an hour long, so I'm pretending it's a drama just to cheat, whatever. But a show that can deal with, just in the course of one episode, if not the entire season, depression, suicide, and legitimate personality disorder issues, that's really remarkable. And they've gone there this season. I don't remember the last time I've watched a show, and I'm sure it's happened. I just can't think of it off the top of my head, where you actually see a main character legitimately try to kill themselves, and not as a joke. But they went there, but they pulled it off really convincingly and well. So to me, that was just kind of had my jaw dropping. Not the way the Twin Peaks episode did, but in an entirely different fashion. But still had left a definite impact on me. Maybe more emotional than aesthetic, but still, that would be my other choice.
Awesome. Well, maybe not awesome, depressing, but
Yeah.
yeah. All right. I might have one more thing, and this is from a series that had plenty of things that were causing my jaw to drop, but where they had the silent movie type scene from the episode Legion on Bolero, I think it was called. That was just a show that was balls to the wall crazy. Did something that was, I mean, they were outdoing themselves in a really, fun, crazy way there. And man, it was just another thing where executed really well, feeling very fresh and original. Even though, I mean, it's like going all the way back to the beginning, but still managed just to feel original because it's just now something that people do and this kind of thing. And it was a really stunning, surprising thing that nobody would have ever imagined that you'd be talking about something like that happening on a show that has to do with comic book stuff, which, this show definitely doesn't go on with that medium, but I'm just imagining somebody writing some comicbook.com review or a preview about the show coming out and, theorizing before it came out, and then just watching that person have their expectations be just totally subverted, I guess maybe is the word, I'm not sure.
Yeah, that probably more than any other television series, movie, or whatever, it's the show that if someone didn't take you aside, if you didn't already have knowledge, like you did ahead of time, that this is actually based around a character or characters from a comic book, you wouldn't know that watching the show. It just doesn't have that look or feel to it, or like anything else in that medium. Maybe because of the people behind it, and so on and so forth. The sequence you described, that's one of the most stunning pieces of this year or any year. The whole Bolero thing, and it's a little foggy in my head right now because it's been a while. So is that where they're actually cross-cutting between what's going on with the actual use of Bolero, and it is the silent movie stuff that's happening on in the other parallel, you know what I'm talking about? Is that that's all?
Yeah,
Wow, I can't.
there was stuff going on. I mean, there was the black and white sound movie stuff, but there was also like, I think Oliver was the character's name, like
Yes.
playing some music with letters floating around
That's all the that's all in the same epic. What a great
all the same scene. I mean, it was
that's insane! Wow.
it's yeah
It's so good. Also,
yeah.
and if I recall, we that's one of our what became one of our favorite things to podcast about. So that was really something.
Yeah, that worked out well. I don't think we planned on doing that. But yeah, we did the entire thing like an actual podcast for each episode. So,
Yeah,
man, it feels like a early part of the year was a long time ago.
it's been a long year.
Yeah.
Thank you, Trump. Anyway.
That's not what she said.
Ew. That's, unless she's a Russian hugger. Okay, so.
Okay, I'm gonna go piss quick if you wanna take the next category. Or do you have one more?
No, that's it. We're done with that. We're gonna move on to the next category. But if you need to take a potty break, I can stall for a minute or two here.
Oh, that was just a Trump joke. We can
I
move
actually thought it was a Trump joke.
on. I'll insert some moisture sound effect there.
Oh, good. Yeah, trickling, dripping, whatever. Okay. So, after talking about shocking surprises, sometimes the most unfortunate surprises are when we're disappointed by something. I don't think we're going to go through really a massive list of any kind. We might just be picking one each. I don't even remember right now, but although we try to stay somewhat positive with our, because it's usually the best of the year, we do have to throw one kind of crappy thing in there. So, with that said, we're going to talk about our biggest disappointment. You can put a parenthesis S in case one of us has more than one. Disappointment of 2017. You can go first again, Dan.
Okay, I'm not gonna do the usual railing against the various shows that everybody knows that I hate by now, even though I'm tempted to just do it anyway, but I'm not going to.
Thank you.
But for me, trying to be constructive and not my usual shtick, I just I guess it's Ewan McGregor and Fargo. That just it just never really came together, either the characters he was playing, and I think he's a solid actor, and I think they gave him an, I don't know if they gave him particularly compelling material to work with for either of the characters he was playing, I guess. But it just never worked, and I think that kind of it just detracted from, I mean, it kept the season from ever being close to an A.
Yeah, the problem with why Fargo fell so far down on my list was kind of around the same issue. I don't blame McGregor per se. I don't think it's his fault. And as you said, he's a fine actor. Just those two, the two leads he was playing, they were just never that compelling compared to like the leads in the previous seasons of Fargo. Whether it be the Martin Freeman character in season one. Or, God, well, season two is just so amazing. I don't even want to, you know what I mean. So we were more interested in all the side characters, but I think whenever it was focused around the main character, we were just never as into it. He did have some really better moments later on, but it took forever to get there, and at that point, it might have been too late.
Yeah, I guess I could also say, I mean, the same thing with Carrie Coon's character too. I mean, there was a couple, okay things, but for the most part, it just kind of seemed like an actor that we like more often than not, just, not really being used well, and just there,
Yeah, say almost a similar issue. I'll probably give her a little bit more of a break than say the Ewan McGregor characters. But yeah,
Yeah, definitely.
compare her character to the lead law enforcement characters on the previous two seasons. I'm never as interested in her on screen as I was, say, Patrick Wilson's character in season two, or Molly in season one, or she might be on the same level as maybe Gus in season one, but I'm not sure. Well, it's funny, when I was jotting something down for my disappointment of the year, one of the things I was going to mention in passing was half or more of season three of Fargo, which is really due to the Ewan McGregor character stuff, as well as like I was a fan of the show Bloodline. Season one is really great. Season two is a little ridiculous, but it has such a nice level of tension. I'm willing to go along with it, even though I can do a really good impression of Kyle Chandler's "duh" face that he does throughout season two of Bloodline. Season three of Bloodline is just ridiculous. I'm watching it. I'm like, why? What? This is just stupid. And yet, that's not my pick. My pick because it because disappointment should be most like you picking something about Fargo. It should be something where someone or something you held in high esteem has really let you down. Thus, you are disappointed. And I have been a pretty big fan of the show Orange is the New Black throughout its run. And season five, I will give them credit for trying to do something a little bit different, which was having the entire season, and I believe Orange is the New Black is a, I'm trying to remember, yeah, it's a 13 episode season, if I recall, all take place over the course of a few days, during a prison riot, whatever. I'm sorry. I would say for the most part, I don't think the season worked very well. And if you take one or two characters and their storyline or storylines out of the mix, it's just not that good. It's really not a good season. There are things that just don't really make a lot of sense. I don't understand how, like, half the time all the inmates are outside in this large fenced in area that seems to go on for, acres and acres. And I'm wondering, why are all the police and everything, why are they only in the front of the prison? Why aren't they all around the entire perimeter of this thing? Why can't they go in through any of these other parts? None of it makes any sense to me. The storylines just get silly. One takes on an almost horror movie quality, which seems really out of place on the show, and is even somewhat demeaning, which is weird on a show which is all about women and created by a woman. Why she would have a storyline like that on it just was really stupid. I was very I wouldn't say I hated the season, but I wasn't a big fan of it. I only finished it just because, okay, I got to get through this because I'm hoping their next season will be good again. But this was just a dumb season of the show. I very disappointed. That's been a per that I think the first the previous times we've done this best of thing, Orange is the New Black has always been in my top 10. And
I get the impression that's not about to happen.
yeah, that is not going to be happening this year.
Man, that wasn't even in the top 25 then, correct? Oh,
No,
yeah,
couldn't do it.
that's a fall from grace,
Yeah,
unfortunately.
that might be the most precipitous drop of anything, just about. Okay, so we have one more category, if we want to call it that, to go through before we both unveil or reveal or whatever the right word is, our respective top tens for the year. Now, I think we're right now, what we're going to do is we're going to talk about who we thought the most memorable characters in television were this past year. So, but we're not actually going to do this in any sort of ranking. Is that right? We're just going to just give our 10. Folks can rank them as they see fit. I'll confess, I did actually rank them, but I didn't really. I felt bad the entire time I was doing that, so I'm happy just to remove the ranking from them. So, how should we do it? Since we both have 10, how should we do this? Do we go back and forth? Do you do a few and I do a few? How do you want to do this?
We can just go back and forth, and if there's but if and if there's any that we both have, we can just,
Oh yeah.
like if I have one, then you can talk about that, and then you can do the next one.
Yeah. You know what? I'm gonna bet we'll I don't think that we'll have that many in common just because we watch of how many different of the shows that we watch, but I'm betting we're gonna have one,
At
two.
least a couple.
I will be shocked if we. There should be
At least three.
two, possibly three.
I'm gonna mark which
I'm going
I'm
to
gonna
do that.
write down.
I'm going to do it right too.
Yeah.
I'm going to put a little star. In fact, I bet you're going to even phrase this one almost the same way I would. This one, I'd be shocked if you didn't have that person. And I'm going to go out on a limb. This will be
That
my only
sounds.
risky choice. That one. And I'll put a maybe next to that one. So I'm going to say two definite, one strong maybe, one maybe. The rest, not possible because, didn't watch the show. Okay, so you want to start it off?
You can start this category if you'd like.
Okay, well I'm going to start right off by cheating because, again, when I was originally writing this, I was doing this at with the thinking that this was going to be ranking them. So, and a couple of these, just to be a smart ass, some of these I will mention what the ranking was and some of them I won't. Just, I don't know why, just because I feel like doing this. So I actually had a tie at number seven. because they're both from the same show and I felt, you couldn't, I couldn't say mention one without the other. So I said, screw it. It's our podcast. I'm going to put them both in the same slot. From the show American Gods, Ian McShane's character of Mr. Wednesday and Gillian Anderson's character, and her character's name was officially technically Media, as in MEDIA. McShane is always fun, no matter what he does, and he always looks like he's having a ball whatever he does. But Gillian Anderson was also a revelation on the show. I mean, I enjoy her on, obviously enjoy her on The X-Files of all these years, of course. And she's not, and she ain't half bad on that show, The Fall, which I have my own issues with, and a lot of these British dramas that she's done. But
And Hannah.
and then Hannibal, of course, Hannibal. But forget all that stuff. On American Gods, she gets to be this god who at different times impersonates, Lucy Ricardo, Marilyn Monroe, and most amazingly of all, David Bowie, to the point where she's almost unrecognizable. So much fun, so different than anything I've seen on television in years. So that's definitely memorable. So there you go.
Sweet. Well, I guess it's my turn now. I guess I will pick, not in any particular order. I'll pick Chuck McGill from Saul, played by Michael McKean. I thought the character was used and portrayed extremely effectively in season three. Not that there was ever I've ever had any complaint about Michael McKean playing this character, but I thought he just was used very, very well and managed to be the bad guy, but still, empathetic. I was able to empathize with him rather than just, having some superficial opinion about him.
You want to hear something funny?
I do.
So, when I was first thinking of this category yesterday, I jotted a bunch of names or characters. Sometimes it would be the character, sometimes it might be the actor because I couldn't quite remember the character's full name or something on a post-it. And earlier today, I was pretty much transcribing them into this little notebook I had. Which is also it's basically the same kind of scribbles, just larger print. Here's the funny thing that happened today. So I'm doing the transcribing, and I finished and I was counting. And remember, I knew that those first two were going to be one slot. And I went, "Oh, I thought I had 10. I only have 9." So then I had to think of another one, whatever. And I wrote down another one. So as you're talking, now I realize why I thought I had 9 when I actually had 10. I wrote in the corner of the post-it, I just wrote the name Chuck, which obviously is Chuck from Better Call Saul. I didn't see that when I was transcribing, so when I rewrote the list, I left out Chuck McGee. I left out Chuck when my original list, he was supposed to be on, 'cause, we love Better Call Saul, and I think Chuck has been a was probably one of the most important things about this past season, and his performance. How he didn't get nominated is insane to me. I don't get that. I don't get that at all. No offense to Jonathan Banks, who does great work as Mike, but this season, if you're only going to give one of them a nomination, it should have been Michael McKean. That's crazy. But he was supposed to be on my list, and for so you know what? Since it's my turn now, I'll tell you the person who ended up taking the slot that was meant for Chuck. So, with all those negative things that we both were just saying about this past season of Fargo, I'm going to say something positive. David Thewlis's character, VM Varga. That's about as memorable a character as I've seen on this show. I mean, definitely there's certain riffs on previous Fargo villains, but still a very original character at the same time that made him different than, say, the Billy Bob Thornton character in season one or any of the more verbose characters in season two. But even though I could have done with a few less close-ups of his teeth, definitely had some great moments, great dialogue, and really a lot of quite the year for David Thewlis between that and his role in Wonder Woman, although it gets kind of stupid that in there too. Kind of a lot of fun, but yeah, that would be my next choice for a memorable character.
And he was also on my list, and one of the few that I picked that I also figured was on your list. So,
I wrote me, that was my maybe I had on my list. So okay.
Yeah, I wasn't super confident about it because I figured you might have picked somebody else from Fargo, but
how funny I would have that and not have Chuck, which makes no sense.
Yeah, but speaking of somebody else from Fargo, and I, you know, the fact that that some of the side characters in the show were almost without a fault far more compelling than the leads were, but I picked Nikki Swango, portrayed by Mary Elizabeth Winstead on Fargo. And it was just a, you know, just an interesting, you know, character that was, I mean, had some intelligence and did some cool stuff, and I really liked the performance that she did.
When you start to say you're going to pick someone else from Fargo, I was sure you were going to go with the Michael, is it Stuttgard, Stuhlgard? I forget how you pronounce his name. Well, the character Stu, the lawyer. I thought you were gonna hit me with Stu there. It's like, well, just his mustache alone, he should have made our list. But no, Nikki Swango, one of the great named characters of all time, and I loved how her character definitely, you saw that character evolve and become a different kind of a person over the course of the season, where she first comes off as kind of an annoying, borderline annoying gun moll type, and then we seriously root for her by the time it's all over. So yeah, good choice. Yeah. I hadn't thought of her at all. I'll go with some, I think you haven't gotten a chance to see it. Going back to Preacher, there was this character, Herr Starr, played by the actor, Pip Torrens. If there's one reason to watch season two of Preacher, it's to see this character, Herr Starr. This thin, bald, scar-faced German nasty piece of business, but so dark and funny and weird. And I don't want to spoil this for anyone who hasn't seen the show yet, but there will be at least one or two scenes with this character you'll just be like, okay, I never thought I'd see that on television. So it's really, really a great, fun performance, and is probably the reason that makes the season two of Preacher really worth checking out, more so than you can even skip, you know, 80% of season one and go right to season two, quite frankly.
Nice. All right, I guess it'd be my turn now. I will pick from Twin Peaks the character Freddie Sykes, played by I don't know, Jake something. My handwriting is questionable here, but you know, just a character that didn't have a huge role on the show, but the few scenes that he was in, him and the ridiculous green glove, just they managed to set it up in such a way where like his goofy weird almost you know, his story and his goofy weird accent. No offense to our, you know, maybe our one out of our dozens of listeners maybe from England, but it just managed to be where every time that I just wanted to see that green glove be used in some weird way, and every time it never disappointed. It was just you know, just stupid thing, but it worked really well, and it ended up just being a hell of a lot of fun. And you know, the show that had a fair amount of interesting characters, that was one that just kind of stuck with me.
Okay. All right. Not what I give you all the credit in the world for going in a different direction from a show that I knew we were both going to be picking from that show. I didn't see the guy with the green glove coming. I'm just impressed you even knew the character's name. Cause I certainly didn't remember it. Well, sticking with Twin Peaks, if we're talking about memorable characters, I'm just going to say Kyle MacLachlan is everybody on Twin Peaks. Either it's dark doppelganger, fake evil, whatever you want to call it, Cooper, or the actual Cooper, or the character that initially annoyed me and kind of was really weighing on my patience. And then kind of like a joke from a show I used to watch called Mr. Show, It went on so long that it became funny to me again. Then it's like,
Well,
Dougie.
Dougie is on my list. Just Dougie. I didn't bother picking the other two, but Dougie is on my list.
Well, the reason why I feel you almost have to have, at least for me, the Dark Cooper as well, because there's a very yin and yang thing going on there, even more so than just regular Asian Cooper and Evil Cooper, because Dougie is so pure, because he's a blank slate. If there's ever been a character ever in television that's a total blank slate, it's Dougie Jones, who does not even know how to walk or dress himself. I don't know how he goes to the bathroom. Although I do remember there was that scene where he was having the issue of having to pee.
Yeah, he had some interesting eating slash drinking slash sex scenes slash playing catch.
Yes, I'm kind of trying to figure out how he did the other thing in the bathroom. I guess we just, maybe I should be happy Lynch spared us that, because I didn't really want to think about how he'd react to the first crap he would have to take or something. Oh boy. So wait, did you just tell us that was Dougie your next one, since I went twin? Did
Yeah, he was.
we just did a Twin Peaks block there. Okay. My next choice for memorable character won't be one that you have, but I mentioned earlier that feud, Betty and Joan, had made my list of the top 25, and if that show's going to make my list, Joan Crawford, as portrayed by Jessica Lange, has to make my list as well. I've not particularly loved all of Jessica Lange's stuff that she's been doing on like every season of American Horror Story. Some of it I've liked more than others, and I like that she's getting, this second wind later in her career, playing these really crazy and over the top or interesting roles. But her performance as Joan Crawford really elevated what could have been a very, B-level tawdry TV show into something that was really memorable, quite frankly. She's just really good. Plus, a hard role to play, because not only does everyone know, not everyone, people might not know who Joan Crawford is, but a lot of people have seen Mommy Dearest and seen like the Faye Dunaway performance, and that's pretty well known. So Jessica Lange had to go up against not just, anyone who's seen Joan Crawford in movies and interviews back in the day, but also a very memorable, iconic performance by Faye Dunaway, which was way over the top. She does a really great job, and it's ver that that's what made me come back and watch that week after week more so than anything else. So, and that's you don't get more memorable than that, I think.
Awesome. Okay, I will pick. Let's see, I got five left here. I will pick for Mr. Robot, Irving, played
Ah,
by Bobby Cannavale, which
ding.
I suspect he's also on your list. And I don't know how to pronounce his last name, so if I got it wrong,
You
technically,
got
who am I?
you got it right. You got it right. Yeah.
Oh,
Don't you
great.
know I'm the last person you have to apologize about mispronouncing
Ha!
names. I mean,
I was going to ask you how to pronounce it. I'm like, why the hell would I ask him?
yeah,
Because,
really. I can barely pronounce my own name.
but yeah, really, really interesting character. I don't know if I've seen him in anything other than this. And I definitely was impressed in with have I? I don't think.
I mean, I've seen him on so many things, but I don't know if you've actually ever seen any of them, now that I think about it. Putting aside any movie work he's done, but as far as television's concerned, he's in an amazing season of Boardwalk Empire, but you haven't seen that. He was in the sounded like a good idea, but turned out to be a pretty bad show after all, Vinyl, that HBO show. He's actually the His character's actually the reason why that show kind of sucked. One of the two big reasons. Just and there's just not there's just nothing likable about his character. He's just annoying. I think they took the anti-hero thing too far with that show. He was also on Nurse Jackie. He's done a bunch of things, but and he's done some movies. He's in a really fine little movie, which is one of the first things I think some people noticed him. I'm drawing a blank on the title. It's with Peter Dinklage, actually. is it, maybe it's the Station Agent. Maybe that's the one that's that movie. But anyway, he's a really good actor. He's always been known as a good New York stage actor as well. But his Irving character on Mr. Robot, although it always feels like he's on another show, because it doesn't, his character seems so out there compared to, I mean, other than, White Rose, at times.
Well, yeah.
You
All the
see.
characters just look at him like, "What the hell is this guy talking about?" I mean, just he doesn't fit in with like the way. Yeah, good point.
But I actually enjoyed that about it. I like that it just someone just plucked him out of like an entirely different movie and just, we're just gonna drop you in Mr. Robot and we'll see what happens. And his scenes in the final episode,
Oofta, yeah,
I
really
think
nice.
what I love about his character actually is, if I recall, and in case there's people who haven't finished the series yet or they haven't gotten to the season yet, I don't want to spoil anything about, that final episode. But I love the fact that, if I'm remembering correctly, I think when this season begins, it begins on with his character and the way he's acting in a, we'll just say it's the way he's acting in a fast food restaurant, which kind of goes on for a bit. And if you watch the show, it's like, wait, what's going on here? Is this Mr. Robot? This is very strange. And I love we see that side of his character there. And then you go all the way to the final episode and you see what the character is or what he's capable of. And you're like, wow, that's some interesting, intense, and very strange character, which is why he's so memorable. So great choice.
Yeah,
Definitely. And go on.
I kind of hope somebody maybe cuts together the scene where he's eating ribs with that scene from the finale, and just
Okay.
with the right editing, that could be really even more fucked up than it was.
Yes.
So good
Well,
stuff. They definitely they the cast needed. I think the cast needed somebody like that. Just a bad guy that didn't fit the same mold as the bad guys we've seen over the first couple seasons, and it really helped to shake things up a little bit. I'd say.
yeah, and also his character added at times a little bit of humor to a certain extent
Yeah.
on a show that sometimes is hurting for humor. So it's the unexpected lightness from a character who turns out to be pretty damn
Huh.
dark.
Oh yeah.
So yes, that was one of the ones that we that that's one of the ones I had a big star next to. I knew that you were going to pick that one, so
Yeah,
and I picked it as well.
yeah. I've got four left. How many you got left?
I have, good question. Let's see. One, two, three, four. I guess I have four left
Okay.
also.
Go ahead and go.
Right. I am trying to think if I should knock off one of the ones that you'd be familiar with or not. Most of these you haven't. All right, I'm gonna go with this one. I'm going to go with the character, maybe. Oh, actually, other than Joan Crawford, would be one, but this is the other character who's actually based on a real person, Ed or Edmund Kemper from the show Mindhunter, played by the actor Cameron. I wrote it down here. Cameron Britton, looks like I scribbled things here. Ed Kemper was a serial killer from the early 70s or late or 60s. I can't remember which. Might have been late 60s. Whatever. 60s, 70s. A very memorable character on Mindhunter. When you watch Mindhunter, and Dan, just gonna tell you right now, this is a show you need to watch. It's got you written all over it. Just trust me, watch it. Really a good show. First episode's kind of is decent. It's like, oh, that's not quite the show I was expecting, but it's not bad. I'll keep watching it. And then we're introduced to the Ed Kemper character in the second episode. And wow, it just elevates the show just, three or four up notches, because he's just that striking a character and different, and just you're hanging on every word. And so whenever he does appear on the show, it's just, you can't take your eyes off the screen. It's just really an interesting character. And I know I just said he's a serial killer, so, but I don't mean it's like watching like Hannibal Lecter or something like that. He's not that kind of a person. But there's just something about him. I hate to say this, he's kind of likable, but until you start hearing about what he actually did and the atrocities he committed, you're like, oh, not sure how much I want to hear about the guy who beheaded his mom and had sex with her neck hole or something. But and he actually did something like that, or the head. Wait, did he? I can't remember if he had sex with the neck or the head. Either way, disturbing. but a great character.
Awesome. Okay. I will go to one that I'm sure we've talked about in one of these lists before, but from the third and final season, The Leftovers, Gary Coon's character, Nora Durst, I felt after season two, her character wasn't utilized as much as I would have liked to have seen for whatever reason. I think this season, her that character really anchored the show and just kind of, I mean, when I think about the third season, that's what I think about the third season of, which was a very good season of TV. Not sure if it'll make my list or not, but it was a good, a very good show, and she knocked it out of the park pretty much nonstop the season.
Yeah, she. I mean, she was really a force to be reckoned with in the third season. I get what you're saying about the second season to a certain extent. I mean, she does have that one great. She has like that one great standout episode in the
Right.
second season between the stuff between her and Regina King, which was one of the best, two character scenes I've seen in television history. But
Yeah.
beyond that. That season really was more about Kevin than it was
Right.
her, and I feel the focus really—I wouldn't say it shifted totally to her, but she played such a much more important part throughout season three, or right up to the end of it. So that's a great choice. She I did not think to pick her. It occurred to me, but I chose not to. If I was going to be a smartass, I was going to pick something from the third season of Leftovers. you know who I would have picked? Man,
Yeah.
if you actually can guess who I would have picked, I'd be really impressed. Come on, take a guess.
Yeah, you would pick I can't remember the guy's name.
Oh, I think you actually know. Holy shit, you're actually gonna guess it.
The guy from
Yes.
that 80s sitcom.
Yes, that's exactly Marklyn Baker from Perfect Strangers. That's who
Okay,
I
well,
would have picked.
it was nice. Okay.
Well, we've been podcasting together too damn long if you were able to figure that one out. Damn you.
Yeah.
All right. I am going to go with another one that you have not seen, and I'll knock this one off quick because I already mentioned a few things about him. My number 11 pick for the year. Neil Patrick Harris's performance as Count Olaf in Unfortunate Series of Events. Never mind the fact that Neil Patrick Harris also in character sings the opening theme to every episode, and the words change every other episode, which is kind of nice. But his performance is so deliciously malevolent. It's kind of fun to see someone he's having clearly the time of his life for this part, even though it often requires him to wear any number of weird prosthetics since he's constantly in disguise as other characters, even though it's clearly always Count Olaf to anyone with to anyone who's with half a fucking brain. But he is so much fun on this. Like I said, he's a goddamn national treasure, that kid. And he's if there's one reason to watch the show beyond the gorgeous cinematography and set design of the show, it's to watch Neil Patrick Harris just play the most fun, evil character that I've seen in anything, be it TV or film. He's just having a ball doing it, and it's fun to watch.
Awesome. Okay, I will pick something from a show you have seen. The show that'll probably end up being number one on my top 10 show list, Ozark. No, it's not. Spoiler alert. It won't be number one.
I was just about to circle something else on my list thinking you were going there, but you didn't. Okay, you check. Go ahead.
Do you want to pick which character? Do you want to try to guess which character from Ozark that I picked?
Oh my gosh, who would you have picked from Ozark? I don't know the character's name though. I can. Oh wait a minute, who was the No, you wouldn't have picked you would not have picked Isai Morales. That wouldn't have been a choice.
Oh, no.
The and I don't know. I can't think of what the character's name is, but the guy. I mean, my first thought would have been like the poppy farmer character, but I don't know who.
No, I picked the character Ruth Langford, I believe was her last name. My handwriting is garbage here, but you know which one I'm talking about? The young like criminal girl that's kind of on the
work.
Oh,
of course! God, I should have thought of her. Oh, she's terrific on it. Oh yeah,
played by Julie Garner. I saw somebody had said she was on The Americans for some length of time, and I haven't seen that, but I'm just curious as to how she was on that. But definitely a standout performer on Ozark, a show filled with generally unlikable characters. The main characters and his children are kind of unlikable for the most part. But this character, even though she tended to do a fair amount of nasty things, somehow managed to be sort of likable and ended up doing some interesting things where I'm not quite sure exactly what her motivations are, but it's very very compelling, and I'm interested to see what more they'll do with this character in the future. But anyway, was she solid on The Americans also, or was this just a complete
She
case?
She was good on The Americans in a very different type of role, a much simpler role that wasn't nearly as central to any plot line the way she is on Ozark. When I was watching Ozark and we first see her character, I went, "Oh, it's so and so from The Americans." Like, and then I got this, and it's like, "Oh, and she's really getting to do something here." She's more of just a young innocent girl on The Americans who's being manipulated by an older guy. And if you think I'm saying something that sounds a little bit creepy, yeah, it is a little bit creepy, but it's deliberate on the show. But she's a fine actress. She actually looks like someone I remember from grade school. So every time I see her, it kind of freaks me out. Reminds me of a crush I had back in like in fifth and sixth grade or something, a little bit. But look, her name's not Maureen, right? Okay, good. That's not her. how could it be her? That was like 40 something years ago. Anyway, good, excellent freaking choice there. Wow. Okay. Should I pick? I'm gonna go back to picking something that you are familiar with. So, and this is one I suspect could be on your list. Although there's at least one other really great choice from that show that I could have went with. But I'm gonna pick Aubrey Plaza's character. We can call her Lenny, or we can call her whatever the hell else we want to call her. As far as what creature or force she turned out to be from the show Legion.
Yep, that's I also picked. That was the first one that I wrote down.
Yeah, first one I wrote down too.
Yeah, and it was not a difficult decision.
I mean, we're both folks who have watched Parks and Recreation, so I think our main exposure to Aubrey Plaza, although she has done other things, indie films, etc., has been Parks and Recreation, and she's kind of the epitome of the disenchanted, eye-rolling, millennial kind of character. I think she still qualifies as a millennial. Who knows? Doesn't matter. What she does on this series, especially the further the series goes on, like when we get to the moment you talked about in memorable moments or great moments, shocking moments, surprising moments, whatever, the Bolero thing, the silent film thing, I didn't know she had this capability. I didn't know she had this in her. It's one of the most interesting characters I've ever seen, ever. Just everything about her performance is just her not getting nominated for that is a travesty. Just like the Chuck McGill thing was for Michael McKean.
Yeah, well, don't get me. I'm not going to jump down the rabbit hole of hating on awards shows.
Yes, I know.
Fortunately, I will skip that. But yeah, I mean, an actress that I've no reason to dislike in any way, and I've always liked everything I've seen her in, but this was, just completely different than how we've seen her before, and she executed it just extremely well, and, tons and tons of different ways. I mean, this character is not a one-note character by any, any sense of the word, and, I mean, just an amazing performance, just across the board. It's, and considering after the first episode, we didn't even know if she was going to be on the show after that point. Yeah, she... Aubrey Plaza wasn't a killed off in the pilot and didn't come back at all. So that definitely is to the benefit of the people that liked it and enjoyed the show, which are pretty much everybody. Just one of our foolish listeners from California was not able to get the show. But other than
that, That's yeah. Let's not get started on that one. We can devote an entire podcast to the dubious opinions of that person.
That could be episode 200.
Yeah. Wow. Because he needs more ego inflating by being mentioned on podcasts. That's why I'm not mentioning him by name. Yeah. It's unfortunately, I think this year, because of between time and life and everything else getting in the way, and so our podcast output kind of was greatly reduced in the second half of the year. One of the things that we didn't do this year that we did the previous couple was our version of, you know, kind of a middle finger to the Emmys. We call them like the snubbies, where we would just talk about and have categories of actors and actresses or, you know, performers who got overlooked by, you know, the more mainstream Emmys. And we usually would get other podcasters to vote. So it'd be kind of like, you know, we'd get like 9 or 10 of us all together to vote and whatever. And I suspect if we had done that this year, both Michael McKean and Aubrey Plaza would have been, definitely would have garnered some, a bunch of votes from any number of us for that, if we had done that this year.
I thought we did that. Don't we do it in like January or February or something? Or...
No, we try to do it around the time of the Emmys. So
I don't know when the Emmys are, I guess.
It was September. So
I guess that explains that. Well, I guess we didn't do that. Oops.
We didn't do it. do you have any left, or did I take?
I have one left. Do you have one left?
I have one left as well.
Okay, I'll go first and let you have the last word. Mine is a character from the. Not just the final season, but from the final season of Longmire, the character Chance Gilbert, and you haven't seen Longmire much or any, as far as I know, but it's a character played by Peter Stormare, who we've seen in a fair amount of things. And I think he tends to play villainous roles really well. And I would be willing to stick my neck out and say that just kind of like, they managed to somehow have Gerald McCraney play an even more like heinous character than his Deadwood character on an earlier seasons of Longmire. I think this might be this character's worst, like the worst character that he's played. Cause this guy is just a complete utter bastard that does these really horrific things, but still manages to be very entertaining at the same time.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
So, yeah.
I've had a little bit of exposure to Longmire. Back in last year, there was someone was at my house had to stay at my house for a couple days, and whenever they had time, they wanted to either watch Star Trek or Longmire on Netflix.
Sounds like me. Very good.
Yes, except, you're not related to me. So whenever I was in the room or if I was eating at the same time while they were watching television, I would see pieces of Longmire, like, hey, there's Lou Diamond Phillips, or whatever. I had no idea what season they were up to at that point. I think they're all caught up with it. It looked like a show I'd kind of get into, but had a nice little laconic pace to it. But I'll check it out sometime in the future. I know you're a big fan of the show.
Yeah.
Oh, speaking of...
You have one more.
What? Okay, speaking of shows that... as far as one of us should check out in the future. I mentioned earlier in the podcast how you should, at one point in the future, you'll check out the show Godless. Jeff Daniels plays his character Frank Griffin on Godless. And I go back and forth on Jeff Daniels. In the right role, I really love him. But he's done some work where I've just been annoyed by the character, like the Aaron Sorkin show, The Newsroom. I hated the character. I didn't buy the character he played on The Newsroom. I thought it was just...
And the fact that he won an Emmy for it over, like, probably 10 people we thought deserved it instead?
Yes, that doesn't help.
That doesn't help. Nope.
But his character, Frank Griffin, you know a little something about Westerns, my friend. You know there's a nice tradition of great villainous characters named Frank in Westerns.
Yeah.
Jeff Daniels very much so carries out that tradition. And then just when you think he's just going to be just purely black-hearted, evil as the Frank, you know who I'm talking about, you know, for anyone out there.
From Once Upon a Time in the West.
Once Upon a Time in the West, one of the greatest Western villains of all time, if not the greatest Western villain of all time? Might be. Very, definitely would have a good claim on that title.
Yeah.
But with this Godless series, which is the 7 episodes, if Godless had just been like a 2-hour movie, his character probably would have been closer to that, Frank. But because it's 7 episodes, we get to see more and more about his character to a point where we tend to understand him more. And we even see there are things about him that are actually human. That he's not completely... Nothing is ever completely black and white. Even though there's the same character that we see at the outset pretty much be responsible for the slaughter of an entire town. And little to no remorse for it. But then we see at other times, like, he is the only one of his gigantic posse who seems to have the capacity to care about other people, or the sick, or the dying, whatever. Just a great performance by Jeff Daniels. Was what hooked me into that series more than anything else did when I watched the first episode. Definitely someone who deserves to be nominated for something next year, like supporting actor in a limited thing. But as we've already seen in this category, the Emmys will screw it up rather than do right in these categories.
Yep.
Okay. So that was our respective 10 most memorable characters. We shared a few there, so there you go. So let's get into the home stretch here. I think now we're up to our respective top 10 best series of the year. Okay, so since I already went through 25 through 11, do you want to kick off at number 10 and we'll just go back, we'll just ping pong back and forth here?
Yeah, that'll be fine. I didn't watch as many shows as you, of course, but I'd say I did watch more series this year than I Trish. Wow, I haven't been drinking, I promise. More shows than usual this year, so it wasn't hard to make a top 10 list. Well, it wasn't hard to find 10 shows for it anyway. It wasn't super easy to get this list in the proper order. And my 10th show on the list would be the third season of Fargo. It just, you know, like we've discussed this plenty in the earlier part of the podcast, where, you know, it was good and it had some good stuff, but it just didn't come together enough to be higher on the list for me. It's still better than, like, you know, Supergirl or something or whatever else I would have watched that possibly could have made my list. But
right. I mean, there's at least there were great characters on the season, and there were some great moments, or even great episodes.
Yeah, but good, excellent production, which I always like.
It just didn't add up to the. It didn't come anywhere near the greatness of the previous two seasons. You know,
nope.
It was good. It wasn't great. Well, my number 10 choice. It's another example of a show that did drop down on my list compared to the previous season, which I think, actually, now that if I'm remembering correctly, this is what was my number one choice last year. The Americans is my number 10 choice this year, and I believe it was my number one choice last year. Definitely still a really good season. It just wasn't as great as the previous one. Still worthwhile. I'm looking forward to how the show does wrap up. It just didn't quite have the oomph that the previous season did. Maybe it's because they had, you know, the great Dylan Baker was on the show, and there was just so many more compelling storylines on it than there were this past season. But still, it's still a top 10 show. It's just number 10.
Yeah, I when I was listening back to little bits and pieces from our podcast as I was getting ready for this one, I noticed that at some point during that, I quickly said, buy me The Americans, because I wanted, like, one of the listeners to buy it for me so I could catch up. That didn't happen in the last year, so I guess whatever listeners decide not to do that, I don't know. I'm not thinking really good thoughts towards you right now, but whatever, you know, you get what you pay for. So fuck you.
Oh, Lord.
But not that I would have had time for such a thing anyway, but yeah, I'm glad it still made your list, but it is a bummer that it, you know, had to fall down the rankings a bit. But I suspect there'll be plenty of top-notch shows above that where, you know, you ain't hurting.
Yeah.
Okay. Number 9 on my list, the show we've already discussed somewhat, and that would be Ozark. It's not number 1. I did end up getting a reputation for, like, you know, talking about it a lot, but I wasn't exactly the one that started that, but I definitely helped keep it going and continue to do so to this day. But by the time I got around to watching it, months after proclaiming it was the best show ever, I was actually, you know, very satisfied with the way that the show worked out. Definitely not a Breaking Bad clone. Anybody that would think that is just fucking clueless and isn't paying attention, or maybe, you know, read about Breaking Bad and thinks like, oh, I'm not going to watch Breaking Bad. You know, it makes meth look good. I don't want to set that example for my kids. No, you're clueless. Ozark is nothing like that. But it's just a, you know, a different kind of show. The way they kind of shoot it with that weird blue filter all the time kind of creates an interesting look to the show that we don't see super often. And I kind of thought it worked for that. And while not all the storylines I found to be super super compelling, I do think that, you know, a show that has a fair amount of potential, and there's a, you know, plenty of really, really good strong moments that I didn't see coming. Which is surprising because I've seen Breaking Bad 3 times, and you think I see everything and they're coming, but not to beat a dead RV. But yeah, Ozark number 9.
There's definitely one moment I didn't see coming on that, which if I had done the whole when we were doing the shocking, surprising thing, decided to do it about a character being killed off. The one on Ozark was one of the two, like, what of the year.
Yeah.
There was one on Mr. Robot and there's one on Ozark, which I did not see coming.
Yeah, both those, and I guess, you know, I suspect the one on Mr. Robot is, you know, the one where the character ended up, the actress ended up on Legends of Tomorrow.
Is she on Legends of Tomorrow?
Yeah, Malcolm, Damien Dark's daughter.
That's not the same actress.
It isn't? I looked it up. I'm pretty sure it is.
No, that's not the same actress. Different. That's a totally different actress.
Really?
Yeah, that's a totally different actress.
Oh, well. Okay.
I'll look it up. We'll look it up later, but I know. Yeah, because the other, well, the one who was on Mr. Robot, she's a much more exotic and a foreign-born person, whereas the one who was on, I think, Legends of Tomorrow is, I think she's just your standard American actress. I know who she is. I've seen her on other things. Unless we're talking about two different people. Could that be? No, it can't be.
We're going to spoil Mr. Robot, but...
Well, you kind of already did there.
Anyway. Are we talking about Tyrell Wellick's wife?
Yes.
Yeah, that's the same actress.
It is not the same actress.
Yeah, I'm looking at it right now. I have the screenshot of the series she is known for, and it's Legends of Tomorrow and Mr. Robot.
You're talking about Courtney Ford?
No.
Then where is she on? What are you talking about?
I don't know.
Hold on, let me...
This is not super compelling.
No, it'll be fun for people to listen to the podcast and listen to me, like, comb through the internet to try to figure out what the heck you're talking about. Because you're talking about, the actress who played Joanna Willock, her name is Stephanie Cornelison, whatever.
Okay. Yeah.
Oh, she played, Valentina Vasta, well, that's a different character.
Oh.
That's a different character.
Okay, for some reason, I thought that was the same character. So I don't know what the heck I'm talking about, but
no, she was on it last year. She was on it back in 2016, which I will admit I had actually forgotten about that she was in that. But that wasn't actually.
Well, I think you're right, because for some reason I thought she was the one that played Dark's daughter, but
no, she had this one. This character had a connection to. God, I think she had a connection to what's his name, the character we hated. Vandal Savage. Yeah, I think she's Vandal Valentina. Yeah, that's probably it. Okay, Apologies for dragging down our podcast that way, guys. We, you know, of course, we couldn't just pause the damn thing and look it up and come back because we don't edit anymore. Where were we? What were we talking about? We were in our top tens, weren't we?
The death in Ozark and Mr. Robot, how they surprised us.
Yes. Which...
Are you talking about the one in Ozark that got hit by a vehicle?
No.
Whoa, well, that was something I didn't really see coming. But anyway, which one are you talking about?
No, that one I kind of saw coming. I'm talking about one that happens more towards the end of the series.
Oh, okay.
Let's stop telling people that there's shocking deaths in it, and people are going to every time they go, it's like, now I know there's going to be a shocking death towards the end. Way to go,
assholes. You know these awesome shows we're recommending? Well, here's these shocking things that happen. So.
All right, let's stop. Stop. All right.
Okay, so who's turn is it now?
Okay, and by the way, while you were speaking, I actually changed the order of two shows here, which is really funny that even in the last minutes I can do that. My number nine choice is going to be the HBO series The Deuce. That was the show that brought back some of the people behind The Wire. So you'll have a lot of actors and actresses from The Wire appear throughout the series. It takes place in the early 70s in the Times Square area. The 42nd Street was known as The Deuce. James Franco plays a double role as twin brothers, which, unlike the Ewan McGregor stuff in Fargo, they're a bit more fun and a bit more and kind of believable. Maggie Gyllenhaal is in it. It's just a really high quality show that really feels. It's got the dirty vibrance of the New York in the early 70s. It's totally captures that look and feel. Something that the previously mentioned show Vinyl, which is also an HBO show, and you know even produced by the great Martin Scorsese, whatever, never quite got. And this show really pulls it off well. Of course, when you get the people behind The Wire doing a show, chances are it's going to be good. And yeah. It was really good. I'm really looking forward to the next season and where they go. Considering it's really a show that's mainly about, well, let's be honest, it's about hookers and pimps and the beginning and what's the very beginnings of the porn industry in New York. That might have kept a few people away from watching the show. People with maybe more delicate sensibilities, but it's worth checking out. Really good show.
I'm good. I haven't got around to starting it yet, but I imagine I'll catch up on it before the second season.
Yep.
And if it's as good as you say it is, maybe it's something we could, you know, podcast about when it comes back if there's nothing else on. But that's a conversation for another day and not for a live podcast. But do you prefer that dirty, dingy 70s Times Square or like today, like tourist overload nonsense Times Square? Like if you just like had to have it one way, like right now in reality, which one would you prefer?
Dirty, dingy.
I had a feeling you were going to say that.
I'll take dirty over Disney anytime. Sorry.
Yeah. Well, good.
I mean,
cool.
Maybe here's the thing. Maybe you don't want to be walking around that area, say at, you know, 1, 2, 3 in the morning. But you know what? I don't want to be walking around Times Square, no matter what it's like, at 1, 2, 3 in the morning. So you know, if I'm around there at that time, there's already something wrong going on. So.
Huh.
You know, the tourists. Yeah. Don't get me started.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. My number eight, and keeping a Dan yearly tradition of picking a show that is not a drama for the top 10 list.
I know what it is already, but
it's the most recent season of It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia.
Oh no, different.
Which was I found to be just almost nonstop outstanding, and they managed to do some. You know, I mean, it was always funny, but they managed to tackle some, you know, more serious topics in a very effective, while still being humorous way.
Mm-hmm.
This season, as well as having some interesting stuff like the Ass Pounder 2000 exercise bike or Quantum Leap shenanigans going on, and a variety of other stuff. So I just thought it was just a really, you know, I felt the show has been pretty decent the last few seasons, but I thought they really stepped it up. And considering it's, you know, not that they do a crap ton of episodes per season, but it's episode like season 12 or something like that.
Right.
It definitely, you know, it felt like, didn't feel like a show that needed to go away anytime soon.
Well, you know what, I'm, like I hinted at earlier, I will have at least one show on my list, which sort of kind of technically doesn't exactly qualify as a drama, but I feel they deal with so much dramatic stuff on the show. It still qualifies as far as I'm concerned, so I can't really knock you on this one. Plus, you do that every year anyway. So I should have known. If I remember the Quantum Leap thing, that alone would be like, oh, that's going to show up on the list at the end of the year just for that. Just for Scott Bakula alone. My number eight choice is actually going to be Mr. Robot. I think we've talked about it a bit, and you may be talking about it a bit more later in the podcast. So I'll just say simply, it's not that I didn't like season two. I did. I genuinely did like season two. But I think season three just did a better job of just, tightening the screws and raising the tension level on it from an episode to episode basis, while still being able to find time, and especially in at least one specific episode, to get a lot of emotional character building, specifically with Elliot's character. And in a season where we could have something as marvelous as the episode that you mentioned in our memorable category, the episode where it looked like it was all done in one shot, kind of a thing. It's I the thing with Mr. Robot for me is, hey, you know what? There's always going to be aspects of the overall plot or story. All three seasons, which I'm kind of a little like, huh, what? And I can't say I completely follow 100%, but I get the gist of it. So that doesn't bother me if that's ever an aspect of the show, which it kind of is a little bit on the weaker side. Doesn't matter because in generally, I get everything that's going on and can follow. It's kind of like when you watch a show like X Files. I know you're a massive X Files fan. And I was a huge fan of X Files, not including its last season or two as well. But when I was a huge fan of it, could I have rattled off all the different aspects and parts of the ongoing and increasingly more convoluted conspiracy theories that were going on, that they were dealing with the government and the aliens and the this and the that, whatever? No, I couldn't. I'm sure there are people who could, just the way there are people who can rattle off serial numbers that appear on every laser blaster in a Star Wars movie. Doesn't mean anything to me. But I got. I knew I could follow about at least 80 to 90% of it, and I was willing to be okay not getting 10% of it because I still could enjoy it. That's the way I feel about Mr. Robot. I might not get everything perfectly, but I get the general sense of it. I don't need to know, I don't need to understand what all the computer code means. I get what's going on.
Well, speaking of computer code, my number seven show on the list is the final season of *Halt and Catch Fire*. You set me up very nicely there, but yeah, it was definitely a at one time it would have ranked a little bit more highly on my list, but it was such a strong season for the kind of shows that I dig. Where while it was a very, very good season with some extremely strong moments and episodes, there was some stuff that was just kind of like, eh, fair amount of, well, pretty much, even though I try to like the character and I enjoy camping and Airstreams, most of the Cameron stuff just never really went anywhere for me. But I did really enjoy almost everything about this season, and some of those episodes towards the end were very very upsetting in a like, oh, didn't I already watch 6 Feet Under this year? Sort of way. So it, yeah. So good job, Halt and Catch Fire. They definitely, I'm glad the AMC let them come back for multiple seasons with nobody watching the show except you, me, and like three of our friends, and maybe like two critics. But I'm definitely glad. I'm glad, definitely glad that we managed to ignore the lame dumb name and the premise, which wasn't super compelling, and managed to watch the entire series and found it to be very, very worthy. So good job, Halt and Catch Fire! Yay.
I'm gonna say that there's decent, reasonable odds that *Halt and Catch Fire* is gonna show up on my end of the spectrum here as well, but not yet. So I'll get there shortly. My number seven choice is my aforementioned new show I've fallen in love with from Netflix called *Mindhunter*, the one I was just saying that you need to watch when you get a chance. Just really different than what I was expecting. I remember seeing the ads for this in the movie theater of all places, I think before It or something maybe. And I thought, oh, it's a show about, the FBI trying to catch serial killers. That's sort of, kind of, but not exactly correct. It's about the beginnings of the FBI trying to understand what is, and even coining the phrase serial killer, because it's one of those things you think that that's a phrase that's been around for forever, and you realize actually it hasn't. Actually, no one even thought to put those two words together until sometime in the late 70s or something. After Manson, after Bundy, after, David Berkowitz or whatever. But it's about the FBI agents who are trying to interview and meet with these individuals to try to learn about what makes them tick and how they can use this information to eventually one day, be kind of a tool to, if not be a predictor, but or help to catch future or prevent future serial killers. But really good. David Fincher is behind the series, and he actually directed both the first two and the last two episodes, if I'm not mistaken.
Three.
Which is kind of cool because he's a big deal guy, but just really a well it's it you know it's the mark of a really great series. Too many series we watch, whether it be network, cable, Netflix, we often can say, you know what, that would have been a better series if they had cut a few episodes because it just ran a little it ran too long, it sagged, whatever. Mindhunter, I was like, wait, it's over? Really? You guys can't give me like another two or three episodes because it becomes
Nice.
the way the further it goes, it starts to become addictive. And now it's like, oh, but we haven't even gotten to. So it's like, can you announce the next season? Can it just come already? I don't want to have to wait like a year for this. Really, I was surprised by how much I enjoyed that show. Really good show.
Nice. Well, number six is a show that I've been hitting pretty hard lately, and that would be the final season of Longmire. It ended up being extremely good. Very, I mean, it's definitely a show that's kind of tailored for somebody like me who spends time out in the West. The show is similar to like a Justified type show, but for me, it might edge that out a little bit just because it has a I mean similar strong supporting cast. Strong, regular actors for the most part, and the fact that it has it's shot in northern New Mexico, in areas where I've been to and hiked in, multiple times before and after, starting to watch the show. So it's kind of cool, like recognizing various landmarks. I mean, the show takes place in Wyoming, in an area which I'm also familiar with, but New Mexico is standing in with it, but just. The various different kind of things they do. It's just kind of like a Western cop show with just a fair amount of actors that we've seen in other stuff. Because it has the same casting directors as the Better Call Saul, Breaking Bad. So you'll see people from some of those shows pop up sometimes, and just it's just a good show. And the final season was really good. I mean, there's several episodes where I was tearing up very rather heavily as they. Tied off loose ends and escalated some plot lines, and I have to say the best acting Katie Sackhoff ever has done is in a couple episode stretch going on there, and not very pleasant to watch, but definitely good to see actors that you like from other shows, which I'm obviously a big BSG fan, being able to do stuff that surprises me at this point.
Maybe I'll be one of the shows I try to when things calm down a little bit, I can maybe put on the because that cause they how many there's been what 5 or 6 seasons of that? I
Six,
can't.
yeah, 6 seasons. It's done now, but there's I think 63 episodes,
All
I
right.
think.
I know there's a lot of people out there, certain friends of mine, who would avoid bothering with a show once they've gotten past a couple seasons. That doesn't bother me because there is no rush. So I've
Yeah.
never, I've, I, and I'm not singling them out because I don't want them to yell at me. So just in general, that's never, to me, that's not a good reason not to go back to watch something. Just so what? And so instead of being able to finish a show in a month, it may be a show you're watching for the next several months. It's not, again, if the show's already finished its run, it means there's no rush to watch it. Who cares?
Yeah, especially, you know, since Netflix bought the show after A&E dropped it after three seasons, and then Netflix, you know, developed the last three seasons, so they have the rights to it. It's not going anywhere. You don't have to rush. Just, you know, it's going to be there.
So I'm still, you know, because I was trying to make sure I was on the same, I'll never be on the same level as you with the Star Trek thing, TV shows, because I just, you know, just not possible. But, you know, I'm still, I finished Deep Space Nine earlier in this year, and I kind of ran through that a lot faster than I would have imagined. And then I started Next Generation, and then I never got back to it because I just got, life got in the way, and then other shows, and then, but I'm finding a way to get back to it now. So maybe Longmire might be my next big show, long, huge number of episode show to watch after I finish Next Generation. Since that might be a while because I'm basically halfway through season four of Next Generation. So there's still another 5, 6, 7. So it's basically I've got like 3.5 more seasons to go through on that. But so I'm thinking maybe spring, summer, I'll get to Longmire, something like that. We'll see.
Wait.
Never know. Okay, so my number six, this would be as close as I get, and I hinted at it earlier in the podcast, my exception to the drama category, even though, as I mentioned earlier, they deal with very heavy drama, especially this season. It's Crazy Ex-Girlfriend. I just love this show. And I know there are some people who watched it or gave it a try, and after a few episodes, they didn't care much for the main character and checked out on it. And I understand that. A very close friend of mine didn't want to watch it after that. I can't do anything to convince them otherwise. But I'm telling you, it's worth sticking with. The main character and the actress who plays her, Rachel Bloom, is such a talent. Just hats off to her, what she pulls off. And what they've done specifically this season. And, of course, in 2017, we also got the second half of the previous season, which was pretty damn terrific as well. But this show just gets better and better. And it's another show where they've kind of cut down, due to any number of reasons with the CW, they've cut down the number of episodes they have per season. It's a shame because compared to certain other shows that I watch on the CW, I would much rather an additional 6 episodes of Crazy Ex-Girlfriend than pretty much any of the superhero shows. And I obviously have affection for all of them, be it Flash, Supergirl, Arrow, whatever. But Crazy Ex-Girlfriend is a much better show than all those shows combined. And I just wish that they just don't have the viewership to justify it. So I appreciate that the CW does keep it around because rating-wise, it's extremely low. But the CW, everything on the CW is rated low because maybe, I guess, half the market, half the country doesn't even get the CW or something. I don't understand what the deal is with that. But it's just a really terrific show, terrific songs, terrific characters. It's a favorite and just misses the special golden circle. Got that phrase out there. One maybe listener will appreciate that of the top five for me.
Yeah, maybe when you start Longmire, I'll start that because you know I haven't seen any of it, but I've you know watched a few of the you know I guess the song and dance numbers while I've been putting podcast audio together for you.
Oh,
and it looks like kind of like you know enjoyable you know kind of you know like my kind of humor when it's being humorous.
Oh yeah, they get away with a lot of stuff on that show. They break the fourth wall. It can be very risque. And I did mention on our previous podcast, so for the folks who listen to the superhero one, that the next podcast was supposed to be I was going to do with one of our one of the folks who usually joins us on the superhero one was going to do another one about Crazy Ex-Girlfriend as well as a few other shows. I think Stranger Things, a few other shows, whatever. Just wasn't able to coordinate to get that done. It doesn't mean we might not end up doing it after all. Maybe after the holidays, it's still a possibility. But just want to acknowledge, I realized on our last podcast, I said that was going to be the next one, and it never happened. It still might. Huh. We'll see.
Rachel Bloom. But she's not like just like the lead actress. I mean, isn't she kind of like almost act like a showrunner on that show? I mean, I'm not positive about it, but I've always got the impression that like she's like super involved with like all the stuff that's going on.
She is. She's essentially, she's like a co-creator. It's her, you know, she came up with the character. She writes or co-writes the songs. I don't know if she's specifically the showrunner, but I kind of think of her that way, so she might be. I've never actually looked into that. I know basically that there's two women behind the show that guide the entire thing, and she's one of them. It's her and this one other woman whose name escapes me at the moment.
Well, I have a lot of respect for that because, I mean, just acting in a show like that tends to be a fair amount of work and all the different, singing and dancing and then, doing all that, she's doing all this other, production type work. I mean, you got to respect somebody that's working that hard to, and then, and just, and but you're not seeing any like, negative consequences, from that, like we've seen, some people like, write all the episodes and the show sucks or whatever. It definitely does, I haven't got the impression from the way you guys have talked about it that, that's going on. So good
That's
job.
true. I'm right now, off the top of my head, it's hard to think of another show, at least recently, where the main on-screen performer was also had to play that big a part behind the scenes as far as the writing, the creating, the producing, whatever. I mean, I don't know if she, I haven't looked to see if she actually has had how big a hand she's had in actually the writing of the show. I'm sure she's had some, but maybe she might be she's working in a show running capacity. I'm actually going to want to look into that. So why don't you talk about your next choice, and I'm going to look it up on IMDb.
Okay. All right. My fifth show has actually fallen a few slots from where it normally is, surprisingly. But it's been a strong year for TV shows
Oh my God, you're not going to say what I think you're going to say. I can't believe
and
it.
my number five is Better Call Saul.
Wow.
Way down number five. I mean, it's a difficult numbers 2 through 5 were very difficult this year. And I mean, I could have, depending on my mood and day, I mean, I could have flip-flopped him a little bit, but when push comes to shove, while the show was, essentially flawless, it was up against some stiff competition, and it just ended up number 5. But like I said, I mean, it could be number 1, and then shows 2, 3, 4, and 5 could all be tied for number 2, the way I, see it in my mind and heart. But I had to rate them, and it's all just. It just fell a little bit.
Wow. I did not see that one coming. I will, before I say anything about my five, I would also say that maybe more my top four, just because I'm just saying that because I know it'll annoy you, but now I'll say my five. You'll see why in a second. If you took my top five and you you put them like dice in a cup and you shook it out and you kept coming up with a different order every time, I'd be okay with that order every time. I think the top, for me, my top five, I feel, I can make a case for any one of them to be in the number one slot.
And that's similar with your favorite movies too, or just like, it depends on the day, but flip a coin and you're fine with saying that's your favorite.
And actually, I'm gonna be. I'm actually, even though I, even after what I just said, I'm gonna be like really honest with you. I might be being a little generous as far as four and five are concerned. Although I think they're great, and I can already guess where one of them is gonna end up on your list. I'm now gonna be shocked if it's not. So we will have very different lists in our five in that regard. I wonder if there'll be like a mirror reflection of each other. No, actually no, because you have one. You already did one that's gonna be in mine. My top three, though, for me, it could be. I literally, when I came down to three, and I was like, I don't know which is one, which is two, and which is three. And I kept thinking about it and thinking about it, and then I finally just wrote something down, and I almost want to say tie, a three-way tie. So I'm not going to do that. Anyway, back to getting on with it. So what'll annoy you now that I said all that? So my number five choice. Which I'll say very little about because I got a feeling I'm going to be hearing a lot about it towards the end of the podcast, so to speak. My number five is going to be Twin Peaks: The Return. Is it officially just, is it Twin Peaks or is it Twin Peaks The Return? I've never been clear on that.
It seems to be called Twin Peaks: The Return.
Okay.
Nobody seems to be calling it season three.
No, I agree without calling it season three, but if you look up Twin Peaks in IMDb, they just have separate listings. They have Twin Peaks the 1990 one and they have Twin Peaks 2017, but they don't have the return on
It's
it.
sold. Yeah, it's sold as a return. So yeah, the
That's what I
return.
thought. The only reason it's not higher on my list, as I know full well it will be on your list, is as we talked about it in some podcasts, there were many times the show tried my patience. There were things that I can only take so much self-indulgence, and I don't, because sometimes it can result in something amazing and gorgeous and ultimately memorable, like whether it be the great episode 8, or even was it the beginning of episode 3, all the crazy stuff with Cooper when he was
Yeah.
getting out of lodge, which was also like this takes everything that they did back on ABC, 20 something 20 years ago, and make it like, that's nothing. Wait till you see what we do now. But if it's my number five show, I'm not going to be negative about it because obviously, generally speaking, I loved it. I made the trek to sneak into my, not sneak, I had their permission. Let me rephrase that. I had permission from my friends who have Showtime, who live around the corner, that I could, go over to their house when they weren't home and watch it every week, which
That
is what I
sounds
had to
like
do to watch
just
it. So
making it.
I had to leave my house to watch this every week. I can just watch it at my leisure at home. So that says something.
Yeah, you use some crazy ex-girlfriend type maneuver to watch your fifth ranked show, Twin Peaks. Interesting. A little bit creepy, but yeah,
I see
fine.
that.
We still love you.
But there's, and I know. I know people who watched it or tried to watch it and just didn't get it. And this might be the only show that I would understand. Like, it's okay if you didn't get it. It's fine. It's all right. But those of us who did, and those of us who, and you, I know folks like you and other friends of ours embraced it even more than I did, because you were more accepting of what I thought were either flaws or indulgences or whatever, because it for you, it added up to what actually made the show so great for you guys. Even those aesthetic choices you guys were able to appreciate. That's why it wasn't going to finish in my top three because of those things.
Yeah.
And maybe I would have liked maybe just one or two more episodes of Cooper as Cooper, but yeah, and screw you with the Audrey crap people anyway. But hey, we. I didn't know what to expect when they brought this thing back, and they had been talking about that for God knows how long. And even where it may have quote unquote failed, it was still a success to me because they didn't shy away from anything. They just did what they wanted to do without giving a flying fuck who might annoy or whatever. Right up until that finale that you mentioned earlier, which. Now that you've mentioned it, now it's literally playing in my head over and over during this podcast. I'm like, oh yeah, I remember that now. I'm like going, are you kidding me? Are they not going to come back? Are they going to do it to us again? But yeah, that's my number five. Absolutely. I'm sorry. I should not have talked about it so much because I know you're going to want to talk about it, but whatever.
No, actually, I think Walking Dead might not have knocked it out of my top five this year, but we'll see.
You go.
My number four is the surprisingly high-ranked Mr. Robot. This season of Mr. Robot really stepped it up for me. And while, like you, even though I'm able to have a photographic memory of the X-Files conspiracy, I have no idea what the fuck's going on in Mr. Robot. I have a vague idea of what they're doing, but I tend to lose track of why they're doing it or what the hell's going on pretty much all the time. It's just more of a show where just you kind of just fall into that schizophrenic atmosphere and just kind of be along for the ride, and that's fine. But it's definitely a show where they stepped it up from season two, which had plenty of strong points, but It just kind of, a middling, just kind of, nah, or whatever. But season three was much better, and just the, between the excellent production value and the really, really awesome performances, the good, sweet new characters and the way they were used, it ended up earning a very high ranking on my list. It's real bad.
Okay. Oh, I did mention before that I was going to look into the Crazy Ex-Girlfriend thing. So, no, the other, remember I mentioned she kind of is a co-creator of the show with this one other woman. That other woman whose name is Aline Brosh McKenna, she's the showrunner for the show. So Rachel Bloom is at the showrunner as well. But she is a co-creator, and she is listed as one of the as a head writer. So even if she's not specifically the writer of any specific script, every single script has to go through her anyway. And so she's probably tweaking and rewriting things here and there with all of them, just the way other writers do, whether it be anyone from Joss Whedon to Matthew Weiner to everyone else. So still impressive work. I had forgotten that you hadn't mentioned Mr. Robot yet, so I didn't even realize it was going to show up that high on the list. So that says a lot. Pretty cool. Speaking of mentioning a show that the other person's mentioned, right, my number four choice is actually Halt and Catch Fire, the final season. Pretty much going along with pretty much everything you had said before, and I don't disagree about your issues as far as Cameron. I've had my if there's one character I tend to have issues with on the show, off and on, it's always been her character more than anyone else, other than maybe Joe in season one, where it was just like a bad carbon copy of a Don Draper wannabe. But I think I'll admit the fact that it was its final season, and I felt they ended it so well, probably ended up elevating the show higher on my list as a result of that, because as we've seen, many shows when they end can kind of fizzle, if not downright screw up the ending. I thought they did a really nice job. It could have been a little bit better. I think the final moment should not have been the final moment. They screwed up the order. The final moment should have been between the two women as opposed to the male character. I don't want to say anything else. I don't want to spoil it beyond that. But because that, if they had ended with the moment with the two women, that really would have been a brilliant way to end the series. That was one of those you went one scene too far, guys. You had the great ending and you didn't, you missed it. Doesn't matter. Still a really fine show for all the reasons you'd said. And hats off to AMC for really sticking with a show that never quite got the, didn't get the zeitgeist thing going the way Breaking Bad did at a certain point, didn't rake in the awards the way Mad Men did, and didn't get, 10 to 19 million people suckered week after week the way Walking Dead has. So
yeah.
But you know what?
Go ahead.
I was just going to say one thing, and as much as we bash a show like a Walking Dead, if AMC doesn't have a show like Walking Dead, then they wouldn't have been able to keep a show like Halt and Catch Fire on. So if you're going to be thankful for anything about Walking Dead, it's like that probably helped them keep a show like Halt and Catch Fire on because of the money that show is raking in. So
yeah, and all the dummies watching it and enjoying it.
Thank you, dummies. Anyway,
yes, you're welcome. Yeah.
Meanwhile, I'm still watching it, so I should shut up.
Yeah, stop it. It's the Gotham of zombie shows. But I'll be interested to see what Halt and Catch Fire, what the creative team ends up doing next. I mean, they definitely seem to have the ability to draw some, really, really strong actors and all that, and they seem to be able to craft a good show. So whatever they decide to, whether their next project ends up being, hopefully it ends up getting picked up and ends up being something really nice and strong.
Yeah, I was excited. It says something about the show that, for me personally, that two of the other shows on my list that were between 25 and 11 featured actors that were on from Halt and Catch Fire. One was kind of a surprise. Scoot McNair is one of the characters in Godless, so it's kind of nice to see him again. And out of nowhere, I was shocked the actress whose name I'm going to screw up, so you know who I'm talking about already.
Yeah, but I'll let you do it one last time. I'll let you screw up her name.
Oh, I'm not even remembering her fucking name right now. But I know it's a name that I always
Carrie.
mispronounce.
It's Carrie Bichet.
Yeah, it's Carrie Bechet. That's right. Out of nowhere, she appears on Narcos of all shows, which really was like what? And considering it's a period, considering Narcos is kind of a period thing, and right now Narcos is taking place in the they're in the 90s now. So I remember thinking, her character on Halt and Catch Fire, it's about the right time. It could be that character. But anyway, really, I thought the show really went out well. So that's why it's my number four choice. And then my number th my top three will be the it could be they could all be number one as far as I'm concerned.
All right. Speaking of shows that went out well, my number three, thanks for setting me up again, good sir. That would be the final season of The Leftovers. Season two of The Leftovers, to me, is one of the best seasons of TV I've ever seen. Even though as to how many seasons would be on that list, it's difficult to say because I've seen so many really good seasons of TV. But it definitely was a standout. And I wouldn't say there was really much of a drop of quality at all. I mean, it wasn't quite as good. If the first one of season two was 100, season three would be, 93.5 or something like that. But it was a very, very strong final season with all sorts of cool stuff happening and all sorts of really depressing stuff happening with a very strong series finale that I can't. I'm pretty sure I have no issues with whatsoever. Which, and I'm picky when it comes to such things, even though I'm not like picky to the like, hey, let's make this about me and go on the internet and make a big deal about it. Sort of picky, as Mr. Lindelof has suffered with in the past. But yeah, just pretty much across the board, I didn't, I was, just a show that was still willing to take some bold chances and do some, really, really. Wreck us here and there. Nicely done.
All right, well, give me a second. Let me open my envelope for what my number three choice is. Hey, look at that. It's the Leftovers.
Yeah.
Well, basically what you said, ditto. Second season, probably one of the best seasons of television I've ever seen. Definitely, if I was same kind of thing, if I was going to rank like top 10 great seasons, it's in there. I don't know if it's number one or not, but it's definitely in the running. I can think of a few. I can only think of a few shows that have like a specific season, which I like. That was an amazing season of television, like season four of The Wire, maybe, or something like that.
Yeah.
You could make a case for season the final season of Breaking Bad, maybe. I don't know, but yeah. So, like you said, third season. Did I think it was on that same level? No. But it was damn good. So
Yeah.
I go along with it. And I also thought it went out really well. I like the fact that the way the show ends, of course, not going to spoil it for because there is at least a couple listeners I know of that I am keep telling you need to go back and watch The Leftovers because they watched only the first season. And they actually liked it better than I did because I was not a fan of the first season the way most people were, many people were.
Listen to Scott, you two listeners. Listen to him. I know he's a know-it-all, but he knows it all in this case.
Yeah,
Just listen to him. He's
just
right.
if you
Watch
see
it.
that it's a wasn't it it's 10 episodes, right? The second season, it's just 10, right?
Yeah. Yeah, if you like season one, and I for the most part, I enjoyed season one, even though I wasn't smiling at the end of any episode. But season two is just, I mean, I don't know. I'm just trying to, like, just imagine, like, the,
I'll go. I'll take it in a different way. Even if you didn't like season one, you should watch season two. That's how good season two
Yeah.
is. Season and any bad, everything from getting rid of the obnoxiously pretentious opening theme, which I know some people like. I don't care. It was overwrought and stupid as far as I was concerned. To any number of issues I have with season one, oh my God, season two is just wow. This is night and for me, it was like night and day. I couldn't believe how good it was. It was just everything about it. It was tension, performances, whatever. Anyway, but we're talking about season three now. season three, I think, was just amazing because it gets a little crazy, it gets a little out there. But yet at this point, and a lot of it's based on the foundation that season two laid, not that season one crap, where you are willing to go along for the ride, and the performances of people like Carrie Coon and just and especially Justin Theroux, and even to some extent Scott Glenn, although a little Scott Glenn goes a long way in the show as far as I'm concerned. It's a great season. Maybe the only reason it didn't hit my number one slot was maybe me thinking, if I didn't make season two of Leftovers my number one choice, I can't make season three.
Yeah. All
But it was close.
right.
Oh,
Well, I guess it's my turn now.
yeah. Even though I kind of I actually I'm pretty sure I know your number two and your number one, but maybe I'll be
Yeah.
no, I'm not gonna be wrong. I know what they
No, you're not going to be wrong.
are.
Season two was a show that really came out of nowhere,
Yep.
and a show that we ended up podcasting about with no prior planning to, and ended up being just thoroughly enjoyable. A show that's just made to, have an intelligent podcast co-host to converse with about it. I mean, every week. I mean, it just absolutely perfect for that kind of thing, as well as just being a extremely well acted and produced and musically scored show. I mean, just awesome. And
Was gonna say it's too bad neither one of us could find one, but anyway.
yeah yeah
I made fun of
yeah
both of us that way. Come
fuck you, intelligent co-host. And the FX series Legion, it was just awesome. And the more I think about watching it, the more happier just all the just bonkers stuff they did. It was good enough to make up for the fact that Noah Hawley was obviously too distracted to make a Fargo season three a top tier truly top tier show, which is fine. But Legion was just, it was just awesome. I mean, just every I just smile about all the everything, all the different theories we had. How I'm still pleased with myself for thinking about using the X-Men TV series theme as our theme music for it. It's just one of those
I
things.
love
It's like
that. I love
something
that.
when something just comes together nicely. So it was a great podcasting experience, but an equally good watching experience. Just just great, 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 bonkers, all sorts of just ridiculous stuff that just, I mean, you trying to explain that show to somebody, I'm like, my mom's a big fan of Downton Abbey, and she wants to go watch some movie with Dan Stevens. It's like, I guess it's not going to come to the theater in this in our ho-dunked rural town. But I'm just like, hey, well, he's on this show called Legion. You could watch him on that, and it's definitely not a character like he played in Downton Abbey, and you probably ain't going to know what the hell's going on. But if you want to see Dan Stevens, go for it. But I could just imagine the look on her face as she tries to figure out what the hell's going on.
I love that the couple from Downton Abbey, that the actor and actress have gone on to roles that don't share anything in common with what we saw from them on Downton Abbey, between Dockery and what she's doing on both Godless and Good Behavior, and what Dan Stevens did on Legion, where everything from convincingly losing the accent to just the character and everything he does on that. Yeah, great, great, great stuff. I might have more to say about it soon. We'll see. My number two choice, which somehow tumbled down slightly in Daddy's eyes, coincidentally rose in my eyes. It actually finished higher on my list than it had the last couple years. That means that my number two choice is Better Call Saul.
Yay.
This season of Better Call Saul, you had two massively awesome things. You had the escalation of the Jimmy versus Chuck storyline, which culminated in that amazing episode, in with the court with the courtroom showdown with them, which everything from the performances to the way it's shot is just so. I think that was one of the episodes that actually got nominated for Best Writing from that season. I could be wrong about that. I know one or two did, and I think that's the one. if it wasn't, that should have been the one. But then, but that felt like that's the way the show would have been a finale. Instead, they get to that kind of midway through the season. And you're like, wait, what's the show going to do now? And then you realize, hey, remember there was a show called Breaking Bad? We're gonna do something which is gonna seem like we're doing fan service, but no, it's really just laying out this tapestry of what's gonna eventually lead to, the Mike and Saul show years from now. And that's by bringing in Gus Fring and doing stuff with and doing more with the Hector Salamanca character, and finally using Nacho in a truly meaningful way compared to the previous two seasons. So much good on that show. I always look forward to it week after week, but this past season, I could not wait for the next episode to come fast enough. I was like, ugh. That's a show that if it had been a Netflix show, I would have watched in one night, because there's no way I would have stopped between episodes to savor the way I should have. So maybe it's good that it's on AMC. I can and it's, well, it's good for us doing the podcast, that's for sure.
No, it's definitely an excellent show, and I mean I really consider it to be flawless. I can't think of a single complaint I have about anything, especially over the last season. I guess for me, just one part of its tumbles that the shows above it. I think that this must be a year where I'm just respecting shows that are taking more bold chances. I mean, and the shows that I have ranked about it are really just sticking their necks out a little bit more, I guess. Not that they weren't doing plenty of interesting things on Saul.
Well, I the way I look at it, as far like your list is concerned, in another year, two of those shows wouldn't have even been there because they wouldn't have existed. So so two shows that just came on just this year, so to speak, kind of, I think those two alone ended up knocking Better Call Saul for you down a couple notches. Otherwise, it probably would have, risen up just because
Yeah,
those shows didn't exist.
it was not an easy decision for me at all.
Well, we all know what your number one's going
Yeah, I know.
to be.
I think I'll skip my traditional claiming that it's something crappy, but yeah, Twin Peaks, The Return. It was everything I didn't know that I wanted, and far, far more. And I suppose I've said all I really needed to say about it during our rather enjoyable, lengthy post-series wrap-up podcast. But it ended up being the kind of thing where I can't imagine that there'll ever be a time where I just this where that this season of this show won't be just completely, totally watchable and will ever feel dated or like something that isn't just really special.
See, I was so sure it was going to be the return of the X-Files was going to be here. No.
Yeah, I
Have
thought
we
about
for
you.
was that this year? Have we all forgotten about
That was this year, and it'll be back in
coming in January?
2 weeks. I think it'll be back, less than 2 weeks, something like that. So it's right around the
I'm
corner.
I'm 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 foolishly hoping that maybe they learned something in the year that's passed and don't make the mistakes that they did in that first thing, but I guess we'll see. But yeah,
Yeah.
back to Twin Peaks. A return that really pulled it off. Yeah, it's wow. Who'd have thunk it? But wow, it was. It's just something that we've. What I loved about it and why I totally buy into it being your number one choice. It takes me back to when the original series was on. And I watched it back then. I was like 19, 20, 21, that whatever. And at the time, all of us were watching that on ABC. We were all like, we've never seen anything like this on TV ever before. Yes, we could find little aspects like, oh, do you guys ever see The Prisoner? It's got a little bit of, it's like, yeah, a little bit, whatever. But it's a singular thing unto its own. And now they bring it back 25 plus years later. And they could have just followed the quote unquote same script, so to speak, as what they did back in the ABC days. And they just said, no, we're going to do something else. While still at least having the spirit of Twin Peaks whenever possible. And whether it be marvelous or maddening, I'm it was just amazing regardless, and worth the time investment that I think we all put into it who watched it. So great choice.
Awesome.
And since I haven't mentioned it yet, I guess it's obvious. I guess you know what my number one choice is. The show that some people said, wow, I've never seen anything that crazy or bizarre or visually whatever on TV. And then Twin Peaks came on in the summer and said, yeah, son, let me show you how it's done. And I get how some people would say that, especially on episode 8. But for me, Legion on FX came out of nowhere and knocked me on my ass. I didn't see this coming. Sometimes there are shows that I know about well in advance and I'm looking forward to. You know, I remember that over the years. Whether it be everything from like the first season of True Detective to Better Call Saul, so on, blah, blah, blah. I knew that there was some show that Noah Hawley was doing that had some connection to a Marvel character, which already made me kind of go, really? Yeah. But it was barely on my radar until maybe a couple weeks before. And that's only because of his involvement. So I was going to be like, oh, I'll give it a shot because he's doing it. But I hadn't seen anything else about it that made me think I was going to care. And then I saw that first episode and I was like, I think I need to watch that again. You know, I was like John Locke in the Hatch back in the old days of Lost. Like, I think I'm going to need to see that again or something. Everything from what we've already talked about on this podcast between the two of us, from the stunning visuals, the twists, the way they name characters on that series was great.
Harry Loudermilk. You
know, great character names. Great weird idiosyncratic performances. Not just Aubrey Plaza, of course, and or what Dan Stevens did, but you know what Bill Irwin did. I can't believe I'm forgetting her name right now because I fell in love with her watching the show.
Well, I think it's Rachel Keller's character.
Yeah, the female lead.
I can't remember her name either.
The only reason I considered putting her on the memorable list, but I figured I would just go with Aubrey Plaza. But
yeah,
but she was. I mean, I could feel my heart thumping in my chest from her because she was just such an amazing, great character. Such a good show. Can't believe that we know someone who didn't seem to like it or get it. Stupid person. The musical choices. What you said before about, and we talked about this when we podcasted about Fargo, that seemed pretty clear that the impact of doing Legion, the time it probably took and everything else, might have impacted and took away from Fargo season 3. At least that's our suspicion. I'm going to say this. I love the first two seasons of Fargo. But if I had to choose between having a third great season of Fargo that was in line with the other two and no Legion, or having Legion and a decidedly lesser season of Fargo, at least until towards the end, I'll take the latter because I was so bowled over by Legion, and I have no idea where they go from here. I'm just now remembering how that show ended. I'm like, oh my god, that's right. There was like cliffhanger after cliffhanger there. We got to get back to that show. When's it coming back?
So, Rachel Keller's character's name was Sid, also.
So. Sid. Sid. Oh, she's the Pink Floyd. How did I? Shame on me for forgetting that. Shame.
Well, just you know. And then that's one show, like, I mean, that was only 8 episodes, but it just feels like, you know, I don't know, 10. I don't know what my point is there.
Yeah,
but it definitely.
Don't say it seemed longer.
8 episodes.
Just say they packed a lot in. They were smart. They didn't drag it out. They packed it all in. They, you know, we got stuff of. We got part of an episode where these two characters are talking to each other and hanging out inside an ice cube. It's. it's so good. Oh man, I can't wait for that show to come back.
Yeah, I'm assuming it comes back sometime next year, possibly, hopefully.
You would think so, especially since Noah Hawley is talking like there might not be another season of Fargo. I don't know. So
yeah,
Again, if it means we get another season of Legion, I'm okay with that. I mean,
Yeah, same here.
I'm afraid after season three that Fargo might be we might end up being more diminishing returns if they continue, unless they can really get back on
Yeah.
track. But Legion's a now a fresher story to go with continuing characters, so I kind of see what they deal with it.
It's been an awful long time since it's been on, and it still ranks very highly in our esteem that we're giving out here. So for it to still be, I mean, I don't know what it was on January, February, something, but it's been a long time, and we're still totally rocking it. So.
Yeah, I think it was. I think it premiered. I want to say it premiered in February. I think we watched it like February through March or something like that. If I'm not mistaken, I feel like it was a February debut for that show. I could be wrong. I don't know.
Yeah, February through March.
All right. So we knew it was a. I mean, we knew our best of 2017 podcast was going to go long. So who cares? But all in all, I mean, it was the year, at least country or worldwise, might not have been a great one in many respects, but at least as far as fantasy, as far as television is concerned, I think it was an exceptionally good year. I think I mean, just based on our top tens, fives, whatever, there was a lot to enjoy this year, and you know, this and there's still more to come, you know? I mean, like I said about Netflix before, I mean, they just released Peaky Blinders today. Black Mirror comes out on the 29th, you know, the show that never makes a list because they keep releasing it in the US, like, you know, at the very end of the year. You know, damn them. And Jodie Foster directed one of the episodes this year, so I'm really looking forward to that, actually.
Yeah, for my top 10, I mean, I think four of the shows that are on there aren't going to be back. Next year, actually five if Fargo doesn't come back. So it'd be interesting to see what other series step up to replace the slots filled by Fargo, Longmire, Leftovers, Twin Peaks, the other
Yeah.
one.
Well,
So it'll be a lot of change, but it definitely seems like things are people are making good TV right now.
yes. There are people making good TV, and then there are people making not so great TV podcasts. That would be us. So there you go. When we get around to it. Yeah. All right then. It's late and it's been long, so let's wrap this sucker up.
Give us a five-star review, too.
Yeah, that too. That would be nice.
And cookies, cash rewards would be nice. With Legion Blu-rays would be pretty cool. Twin Peaks one also would be nice for both of us.
You know, I've actually
Cat
thought.
food.
You know, I've actually thought about doing a thing where, you know, you could use. There's a couple of different websites you could do it through, where you can like put out a thing where you can create like T-shirts kind of stuff for the. For our podcast to kind of sell. And I thought about it and I said, yeah, there's like maybe four or five people that you know for sure, maybe six that'll buy them. And I don't know how what the minuscule cut you get out of that is. It's like, I don't know if that's really going to be worth it. It's too bad. It'd probably be a really cool shirt. But, and maybe I will. We'll see. I'll think about it. I'll probably do something which I'll get in trouble with licensing or something, and everyone like, but Scott, that's the business you were in for years. How do you not know that? I was like, I don't think anyone knows.
The logo just needs to be like an RV with like pizzas for the wheels, and that about sums it up.
So if you, not you, Dan, but you people listening, whoever's still listening at this point, if you enjoy this podcast, other than what Dan just said. 5-star ratings and reviews, which you do if you found us on iTunes, which is how you can subscribe to us, if you want to subscribe to us via iTunes and then rate and review us there. But if you just want to talk about shit with us, you can talk to us on our Facebook page. You can find us on Facebook, the Serious TV Journal Podcast. Like the page and join the conversation about pretty much any TV show you want, or if we like you enough, you can talk about anything there. We won't probably ban you unless you're someone in California with really weird, stupid opinions.
And no taste.
And no taste, and afraid to leave, you know, within 5 miles of your house or something, or 5 feet, whatever it is. So that's Facebook. I just mentioned iTunes. Oh, and you can also follow us on Twitter. Our Twitter handle is at STVD Podcast. It's STVD as in Serious TV Drama Podcast. Although it seems like we hardly tweet anywhere. I wonder why that is. Oh, yeah, it's me. that's about it. This is likely our final podcast for the year, although it's not out of the question we might try to get together, but I think time-wise, I think you're going to be away for the rest of the year.
I'm pretty much working the rest of the week, and then if you want to record something on Christmas Day at night, I can probably put it together. I'll be on vacation from the 27th through the 1st, so not too likely I'll have time to do any production other than this one.
Right. So this would be our final one for 2017. It's like, you know, I like that our number of podcasts kind of reduced this year because we just got tired.
We did an average 1.5 a week this year. So that's okay.
Oh yeah, what we did last year, and plus what we did in previous years was crazy.
Yeah, this year we had a lesser of an output, but we still managed to maintain the same low quality.
Yes.
That's saying something.
You think with all the sabbaticals, because pretty much we were doing it rock solid through the first half of the year, and then pretty much from like July, I think from like July to now, I'm going to guess we've done 4 or 5 podcasts, maybe? I can't really think of it right now.
Yeah, we're like maybe the Congress TV show podcast, where we just take the whole summer off, and then we're just useless like from then to the holidays.
Yeah.
So, good job. You're the Senate, I'm the House. We both suck.
Yeah, instead of the government shutdown, the podcast shutdown.
We're still better than the executive branch. So.
Well, that, you know.
This one, anyway. The executive twig is more like it because, you know, that shit isn't fucking thick at all.
Good fertilizer. So next year, obviously, we'll be back. I'll see about whether or not I'll be able to do one about Crazy Ex-Girlfriend, etc. with Jason, but I might end up doing like a summing up after the show has finished its run. I don't know about that. And there's a possibility, only because we did it with Force Awakens, that we may decide to do one on the Star Wars movie, which... every day I see things online, realizing it's like become this oddly polarizing film.
Well, pretty much like everybody I know personally and like respect seems to be okay with it, and people that just, I don't know, like want to go on the internet and complain about Nickelback and Guy Fieri want to badmouth this movie, which I haven't seen yet, but I get the impression that our Breaking Bad alum probably isn't going to be letting me down too much here.
Yeah, we'll probably talk about it on a future podcast. My two sentence thing would be: there's stuff to mock, and there's stuff to adore. But the mockable stuff aside, which it should be made fun of. There are a couple of things where it's like, what? there's one since I got. One's just goofy as hell, and the other one's just like, when I kind of blame on the director a little bit. But the things I see more people complaining about, I'm just like, oh, shut up, shut up. You're embarrassing yourself. You're embarrassing me. The fact that I even know you, or you know that we're both quote unquote geeks is just ridiculous. And I had to see it twice to really make up my mind about it. I'll admit. When I saw it the first time, I was like, I'm not sure how I feel about this. But when I saw it the second time, I was like, okay, I have issues with it. But we're not talking like this is Batman v Superman, where I had to like cherry pick a couple things I liked, even though I knew I was like trying to find nuts in a pile of shit. You know, there's lots and lots of great stuff in this movie, and people are like going ballistic on it or just foolish.
People, I think, you know, there's a certain segment of people that are just, you know, acting, well, you know, maybe it's valid, but the fact that, you know, there's just Star Wars movie upon Star Wars movie coming out in the future, and, you know, all these movies, and too many comic book movies, whatever, just like, this is the world we live in now. Just fucking adapt to it. You have 70 years of watching fucking Criterion Collection movies. This is the world it is. Adapt. You know, the fact that they're going to make 7 more Thor movies doesn't mean that fucking, you know, Akira Kurosawa films are garbage now. Just, I'm sorry, but this is just the way the world is now. So ripping apart every single movie that's put out by fucking Disney or whatever massive trillion-dollar fucking conglomerate is doing, it doesn't, you know, you just don't have to do it. You can do it, and maybe some of your points are valid, but if you're doing it because you're trying to, like, you know, stead the tide of this is what progress looks like. Maybe it's not a good progress, but this is what happened, so adapt to it or fucking, you know, suffer and block people who don't agree with you.
Yes. Okay, I'm so tired. Let's finish this up.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, Merry Christmas.
To you as well. Happy Hanukkah or Christmas.
Oh, both work for me. I'm not celebrating them both equally this year. So.
No, but hopefully I'll have a nice hike and you'll go on a waffle quest or something. Usually you end up with a waffle sometime around Christmas.
Wait, I do or you do?
You do. Usually you reward yourself with some, you know, ridiculous waffle conglomerate, and I just go hike in the cold.
Oh, now you kind of got me wanting to go get a waffle tomorrow. See what you've done? You've put the thought in my head.
You put the waffle in your stomach, and I put it in your head. That's cool.
Okay. So
we're tired.
Yes. Because we want it to be a 3-hour podcast at this point. Oh my God, is that 2:45? Oh my God. Okay. Wow. We've done back to back podcasts that are insanely long now. So thanks everyone who stuck out this podcast and chose to keep listening to us tiredly rambling here with no alcohol as an excuse.
Nope.
Everyone out there, have a happy holiday, no matter what it is that you're celebrating, and have a happy new year as well. I think we all at least are going to be flipping the same page in the calendar. And we look forward to being somewhat middling and entertaining for you next year. So good night, everybody.
Good night.